Hey!
Yeah! How's it going?
Whoa!
Wow, wow. We're starting off with a lot of property damage, huh? That's
good. Oh,
it's all right. Man. I paid for it.
Oh, you paid for it.
Yeah.
Oh, great. Welcome to Wild Cards, guys. It's Friday night. And yeah, it's Friday night, so that means that it's time for Wild Cards, which is our Savage World show. We're currently in the world of Deadlands Reloaded. That could change, but for now, it's not going to. My name is Jordan Caves Callerman. I will be the marshal for this evening. And look, I even have a shiny new U.S. Marshal's badge to prove it.
Fancy.
And after everybody introduces themselves, well, no, we'll start now. Wild Cards, if you follow us on social media, you may or may not be aware that the Wild Cards group went on a little bit of a field trip last weekend to Calico Ghost Town, which is a for real ghost town that they have turned into a kitschy tourist trap. And it was a lot of fun, and we were able to get this super cool old-timey photo taken. Can we put that over in under the dice can?
Under here.
Can we switch to the dice can?
Where does it need to be?
Where can we
put it? It's going to need to be like right here.
The people need to know.
If there's not enough ceiling glare on that.
Up a little bit.
Oh, look at that. Majesty. We were able to get that done, and it was pretty awesome. And I'm actually right now wearing the same Marshall's badge that you cannot see me wearing in that picture because it flipped over on my collar. But I was wearing it, and you can believe that. So I would like everyone, we'll go around the table, we'll introduce everybody, say what character you're playing, and then what was your favorite part about visiting Calico Ghost Town?
Oh,
what was your favorite part? And while you guys do that, I'm going to hang this up on the wall real carefully.
Do it.
Don't look at me.
You're going to need the
Don't look at
careful.
Me.
Out
what?
Yep. Oh, God.
I see it.
Oh, God.
Guys, you're supposed to be introducing yourselves. We'll start. Oh. We'll start with Megan.
Oh, with me then. Okay. Hi, I'm Megan, as he said, Megan Caves, and I am playing Rosaline Byrne, and she is she would consider herself a high class, very high class escort. She's also a huckster. She's a knife fighter. And I don't know, what else is important? She likes to deal in blackmail, and she's kind of got a Bonnie and Clyde relationship with Gabriel over here.
And I am Jordan Pridgen, and I am playing Gabriel Pryor, who is a preacher on the surface, but deep down he's actually just a con man who with a silver tongue who uses that to go from town to town and get what he wants. And my favorite part of going to Calico Ghost Town was there was a mystery spot, and if you stood in one spot, you looked a couple inches shorter than you did if you stood in another spot.
Yeah, no, if you stood further away, you looked a couple inches shorter.
But why?
But why?
It was more like a Ouija board, too. It was kind of like everyone going like, oh yeah, you totally do. None of we all see it.
I guess.
No one's moving it.
Yeah. You look a little shorter
it's
now.
It's working.
It was silly.
What about you, Megan? What was your favorite part?
I don't know. I really liked the picture, to be honest. Also, the lady who took the picture, she was so excited that we were there and we had ideas about like what our outfits were going to be.
She may be watching now.
She might be. I hope that she is.
So if you are, hi.
Hi. Thanks for watching.
Thanks for the picture.
Yeah.
All right. Awesome. We'll go over here to. Well, I won't say your name. I won't steal that from you.
You don't remember it. Hi, my name's Dom Zook.
That's it.
I'm playing James Bogue. He is a gunslinger in the mold of any sort of spaghetti western sort of anti-hero. Comes from a troubled life in the CSA and then eventually became sort of a mercenary bounty hunter and is now on a mission, a manhunt, to track down a murderer of a small town that James had sworn to protect. So he's trying to find this guy known only as the Baron.
Dun 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 dun. Dun.
Wow.
I got there first.
But now I'm with these guys helping them out. So my favorite part of the
so many to choose from.
Yeah.
There's so many like.
There was skeleton with bunny ears.
Yeah,
that was good.
It was the Easter festival at Calico.
There was a straw pile.
Oh, Twinkle Time, the band.
The band.
Oh,
the Easter band.
Very Western of them.
Was very cool.
They were
Stop
rabbits.
Saying, don't make a list.
Oh,
yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, you're stealing Talene's stuff. Talene, tell them what your first name is.
I guess you already know that my first name is Talene.
Damn it. I'll get there.
Because Jordan gave it away.
I'll get there.
Wow. Ugh.
What a jerk.
I don't even know how to go on from there. I'm playing a character named Tortlaw, who is a Native American from the Coyote Nation Scout, really good at things, hangs out with these guys because they're entertaining. My favorite part, I actually do have two. One is a joke, the glory hole.
The glory hole was pretty good.
Yeah.
And it was presented, it was just a name of an area in the mine, and we actually had a walking tour pamphlet that had a section on the glory hole and did not explain at all what it was or why it was named that.
Why it's called the glory hole?
It had like something about like sandbags in it.
I tried to Google it later and I got things that did not explain.
They really offered more questions than answers. They did. What happens when you go to the glory
hole? The mine consisted of like one pathway over here and then another pathway over there and stairs out.
It was weird.
That was just one mine though.
Yeah,
there,
guys.
There are multiple.
There were
mines.
Several.
I googled miner's glory hole and now I'm on a list.
Don't do that, kids at home. Tilly, what was your real favorite part?
My real favorite part was the gunfight. Oh. Yeah. In which appeared the real Tort Law.
It was That's uncanny. True.
It was amazing.
There's a picture of her somewhere, I feel like. Oh, there's a picture with you. Where's that one?
Yeah, we took a picture of you with her.
You should post that.
And she accidentally, comically, killed everyone in the gunfight on accident. It was a real piece of theater, guys.
Yeah.
But in all seriousness, it was a lot of fun. We had a fun time. So if you are in Southern California or in Vegas, because it's pretty much equidistant, you should check out Calico Ghost Town.
No, I didn't get that one.
My favorite part was spending the day with all of you guys.
Oh.
Yeah. That's real. Don't say that. Behind the camera, we have Isaiah. Woo. Hey, Isaiah, how's it going? Thanks for helping us out. And we also have Tyler Rhodes. That's Tyler's hand right there, shaking the camera.
Yep, knocking the camera around. Good work.
Oops, Tyler. Yeah,
good. All right, so guys.
Yes.
Last time, some weird stuff happened. You guys, we started with you guys finding a weird exploded carcass. Tortlaw was actually able to figure out that this weird pile of rancid meat and shoes looked like someone had blown up. And while that was happening, the town, exceeding the sky, thank you for
coming.
The townspeople had gathered in the middle of the town trying to decide what to do since the Holbrook gang had issued an ultimatum, either tie up all of these new strangers in town, that'd be you guys, and leave them hogtied outside of town for the Holbrooks to do with as they please, or they would burn the town to the ground. Now, the marshal of the town had some strong words for the assembled crowd about why they should give up the new preacher and his friends, but Gabriel Pryor was able to swallow his vocal unction elixir, which tasted of cotton candy and cucumbers, and sway the crowd with his melodious voice. And you really got the entire town on your side and made quite a fool out of Marshall Hurless. At that point, you guys decided to kind of nip this whole thing in the bud and try and find Johnny Carrington and his group of men that had come into town and issued this ultimatum and take care of them in the night before anything even happened the next day. So you were able to track them down using a combination of Rosaline's spells, where she could see through Johnny's eyes, and Tortlaw's tracking assisted by James Bogue. You guys found them. You caught them unawares while they were asleep. Your plan went off without a hitch.
With just the greatest amount of confidence.
Yes, so much confidence.
It was such a clear, well-defined plan.
Yep.
I'm impressed by that.
That you were able to make them all throw down their guns, and you took their leader, Johnny, prisoner, and took him back to town. You humiliated him quite a lot. Yet despite all that, he still seems fairly confident.
Not going to come back to bite us.
Definitely not going to come back to bite you. You sent all of his men away. Seemed like the good thing to do at the time. But he's a bit unsettlingly confident. And you brought him back to the church. You had told all the townspeople that they should meet you out in the town square in the morning to hear your glorious plan of how you were going to deal with the Holbrook gang, and they were excited to hear it. And you guys went to sleep, not quite sure what the next day was going to bring. During the night, Rosaline was awakened by some strange activity in the cathedral area of the church, where she saw a stranger praying and saying some very strange things at the altar. But when she got closer, his face was all distorted and strange when he seemed to see her. And then she woke up standing in the church. So we're not quite sure what to do with that. And real quick, before we jump back into everything, I guess I should go over some rewards while everybody goes around and pulls their fate chips from the hat. You get three, you get three, you get three, you get four, because you are lucky. Guys, there's some different things you can do to donate for in playing Wild Cards with us, playing the home game at home. Forsaken!
Thank
you for the donation.
Thank you.
You guys can use your XP to donate for a toast. We will all raise our glasses high and toast to whatever it is you want us to toast, as long as you're cool about it and you're not a jackass. We will do it. There are 5 of those that can be redeemed with XP. After that point, they will start being charged for at a $5, $10, $15, $20. You get it. It's a pattern. Apart from that, you can also donate to get a piece of cursed Spanish gold for one of the players at the table. This allows them to reroll any attribute or skill roll that they make in the game. But after they use it, it goes to me, and I can use it for that exact same purpose. So, there's a little, that's where the curse comes into play.
Do we want to go through what we have?
We will,
again?
We will.
Okay.
You can also donate to get them a fistful of cursed Spanish gold, which is 3 pieces of cursed Spanish gold, and that can be for anyone here or for the table in general. You can donate to heal the players at the table. Now, they only have 3 wounds they can take before, if they get injured one more time, they could potentially die. So it's a very brutal system.
It's a big deal.
If they get into combat, that's a big deal.
A very big deal.
And then on top of that, you can make them draw a card from the official Savage Worlds Adventure deck that gives them the ability to affect the narrative or the gameplay at a pretty major level. Only 1 draw for each player each game, so keep that in mind. And then on top of that, there's a bunch of tier rewards that can be unlocked by cash donations that are made to the game, so you guys should check those out. Some of them, I think, are pretty interesting tonight, so take a look at those. And then, yeah, let's do a quick Cursed Spanish Gold count from everybody at the table so chat knows where you all stand right now.
Starting with Mage Hand.
I have 6. 6.
I have 4. Cursed Spanish Gold.
11.
I have 14.
Jeez. It's crazy.
That's the...
And I have 4. So keep that in mind.
Did you say what happens with Cursed Spanish Gold?
Yeah, you use it, then it goes to me.
Yeah. Okay.
It's cursed.
Maybe we should show them...
Oh yeah, real quick. We got some great minis from James V that we talked about last week, and Megan had the time to paint some of our characters during the week. Mm-hmm. So let's show those.
See. Where's the best? Can you see him here? Is that the best angle, or should I do this other camera?
That's good.
Yeah, this is Tort Law. And Yay. You can see she's got her CSA jacket on there. And then this is Gabriel Pryor. With his book there.
Nice.
And this is Rosaline with her cards. And we don't have James yet.
No James yet.
Nope.
But we will.
But he's coming soon.
Coming soon.
To a table near you.
And Megan painted them, and she's very good at painting.
I did.
So cool.
To a table near us.
We'll have some close-ups of those on our Twitter.
For sure. Now, guys, is there any last bit of bookkeeping that we need to do before we saddle up?
Let's see, so this is, we ended at, in the, like right before the morning, right? Getting it clear.
You guys were getting some sleep.
Okay.
You guys were getting some sleep.
Okay.
I'm gonna open the cursed Spanish Doritos real quick.
Yeah.
Whoa, taco explosion.
This one's a dud. Sorry, guys. It's a dud bag of taco explosion.
We were prepared.
Real quick, before we get in, we have a donation from Forsaken for the Marshal to do with what he wants.
Oh,
and to reach the monthly goal. Did we reach the monthly goal again?
Oh,
nice.
Yeah.
This is our monthly stretch goal.
So
you guys are nailing it.
That's
nailing
awesome.
It. We're stretching so hard. You can feel the stretch in your hamstrings.
Oh.
Yeah, or your fingers.
Well, I'm a gunslinger. That's
okay, that makes sense. To do with what I want. Okay, that's $28. So let's see. It's...
Save it for heals, man. Just... You know, heal us when we need it.
Yeah.
You should heal us. I feel like...
Yeah. No, that's actually going to be really difficult to split up. hold on, because that cannot be evenly divided by the amount of donation things that we have. So why don't we do 3 pieces of cursed Spanish gold for the table?
All right.
Well, we didn't say how many we had for the table. We have 8 for the table. Now we have...
11.
11.
So that's 15, and then, yeah, we'll hang on to the rest of it and see what pops up as we go. Mm. All right, so guys, let's saddle up. Nailed it. So we open on the town of Coldwater Creek as viewed from the church. Sleepy little burg down there on the land below. It's dark, but the sky is lightening. In fact, the sun is raising up over the horizon, and as it does, and starts to crest up into the sky, a lonely rooster crows down in the town. Aww. Which takes us to the front of the church.
Poor lonely rooster.
Where we see Tortlaw sprawled out on the front steps of the church.
Oh yeah.
Asleep. Tortlaw?
Yeah.
Will you make a vigor roll for me to see if you can wake up?
I will.
Since you are a heavy sleeper.
I am a heavy sleeper. Mm. Vigor is not my top stat.
Not your strong suit.
Nope.
Whoa.
Oh. Oh. That aced, so roll that again.
Okay.
A 10.
You figured it out.
It's a success with a raise. Torla, you spring. Do you want to do like a backhand spring as you wake up?
No.
Okay.
I would not like to do a backhand spring.
Describe Tortla for us. What do we see as she wakes up in the morning? What does she look like?
Well, to sleep more comfortably, she has taken off her CSA jacket.
Okay.
And pillowed it under her head. But she's a roller slash walker slash talker.
Okay.
So she has woken up face down, maybe in something. Okay. Disgusting. Sprawled out, like eagle style.
Was she an eagle though?
Probably. Sleep transforming can happen too.
Yep.
And the thing that she's like, she's laying, sleeping real deep, and then she's like, oh no. And leaps up and then runs around in a circle, just being like, what is this? What's on me? What's on me? And then looks around, is like, I'm good. Because no one's there.
Awesome.
Is no one there?
No one's there.
Good. Mm.
And also, there's nothing on her, right?
No.
So it's a win-win for her.
Yeah.
So the camera, well, not the camera, we, all of us, you and us together, mysterious strangers in chat, we pan up to the upstairs, go in through the stained glass window up there to find James Bogue asleep in his bedroll up in the upstairs. But you'd probably be awoken by the sound of a rooster crowing. What do we see, James Bogue?
James, relatively tall, about 6 foot. Got a mustache, finally coiffed mustache.
Ooh.
First thing in the morning.
Yeah, first thing
he
in the morning.
He wakes up
just
with that.
Stays that way.
Yeah, it's never showering is what does that. puts on his clothes, generally wears somewhat darker clothes, blacks and grays, a little vest.
Would you say he's a man in black?
You might say he's a man in black.
Interesting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I like to say he's Lee Van Cleef. So if you have that picture, that mental picture in your head, that's sort of what he looks like.
Or if, like me, you don't know who that is and you forget to look it up every week, do that now.
Yeah. Yeah, basically, you know, kind of, he's got those somewhat beady eyes, but there's a little bit of a twinkle in there that you feel like he's got something he's hiding a little bit. Little bit of mustache, a little bit of gray around his temples. Very very worn, leathery face. Throws on his clothes, holsters up, and
gets ready for the day.
Gets his pipe tobacco out.
Gotta have that.
Taps it in and lights up and goes outside.
Morning pipe.
Okay. Yep.
That's
all right.
What he does for breakfast.
And as we follow him down the stairs and out through the main area of the church, we go back into the living area where we find Gabriel Pryor and Rosaline waking up in their bedroom back there.
Well,
let's start with we'll start with Gabriel.
So, Gabriel, description-wise.
Jared Fortune, thank you for the follow-up.
Thank you.
Gabriel's in his probably like early 30s, and he looks a little older than he actually is because he wears some like fake gray in his hair.
It's
like
fake gray. I was wondering about that.
Yeah, yeah.
Nice.
He powders his hair to look a little older than he actually is.
Okay.
Because it creates a certain level of respect that people like. So he has like kind of a clean cut. What's that? It's like mustache.
Van Dyke, you said?
Van Dyke. He has like a clean cut little like Van Dyke mustache kind of thing going on. And he wakes up and kind of like shakes himself out of bed because he hasn't been sleeping particularly well tonight because there is this big to-do that is coming up the next morning.
That's true. So he maybe looks a bit troubled as he rises.
Yep.
All right. So and then moving just over to Rosaline, who did not sleep super well.
No, she didn't sleep well. And I imagine that she's a bit groggy. Rosaline has very, very dark, almost black hair, and she has very, very pale skin, kind of the classic Irish, non-redheaded Irish way. She's Irish, so, you know, there's that.
By way of Boston, I believe.
By way of Boston, yes. And she is in her early 20s. But this morning, she's a bit groggy, as she had what she thinks was a bad dream last night, but this is another weird incident that's happened in this church among, I think, two others. This was the third one. So she's a little unsure. And of course, just same, there is kind of a to-do happening right now. So she's maybe not as worried, but...
Doesn't maybe look as put together as she normally might be on this
day. Probably not right now, but she's going to get up. She is going to get up and put on one of her nicest dresses because she needs to go out and sway the town today, so she will look her finest.
Gotta face the day.
People to impress.
Oh, yes.
Now, before we continue on, two pieces of bookkeeping I'd like to clear up. The first tier reward has been unlocked.
Ooh.
Their reputation precedes them.
Oh.
And secondly, everybody raise a glass.
Well, of course.
We have our first toast.
Oh!
From Sifatrex.
First, did you not want to tell everyone what we were drinking?
Oh, that's right,
today?
Yeah. There's been some confusion in chat about whether or not we're all drinking root beer, which is just simply not true.
No.
We bring funnels and we put whatever we want in these. So, Talene, what do you got tonight?
Root beer.
Root beer. Whoops, shouldn't have started with Talene. Don't worry, guys. It's going to get super hardcore. Dom forgot his bottle and he has a shot glass. Dom, what are you imbibing this evening?
Whisk tea.
It's just tea. It's actually just tea.
It's just tea.
Megan. Megan, what do you have in the bottle?
I actually have Sprite and vodka.
Okay, and correct me if I'm wrong, that is the exact same Sprite and vodka that you had last week that you just put in the refrigerator.
Yep.
Nice. Not at all gross.
It's not. It's still fizzy. It's still fizzy.
It's still fizzy? Wow. Yeah. Jordan?
And I've got Modelo Negra.
Yeah. I also have some Modelo Negra. So this is our first toast from Sifatrex, Sci-Fi T-Rex to you uninitiated, to Talene and the inevitable butt stuff that'll happen tonight. To Talene and the inevitable butt stuff that'll happen tonight. Set them up, knock them down. Doesn't have to be inevitable. That's a decision we can all make together.
Is it?
It totally is. All right, hold on, guys. I spoke too soon before we put our bottles down.
Oh, wow.
Maybe we should all raise our bottles once more. Because the second toast is coming in now. Oh, and Tyler's in crunch mode. Because I said it, but it hasn't yet been typed. So don't worry.
Oh my gosh.
I can stall.
Look at the big sweat drops.
I can stall with the best.
Out on his
vein
forehead.
Is like about to explode.
He's like a hacker in a movie right now.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He's typing so fast, you guys.
He's going dum
dum dum dum dum dum
dum. If he doesn't get rid of the security system before we roll through the door,
guys,
we're dead.
Right?
This is from the Bard 1971.
Oh.
A toast to. A toast to. Set him up. Knock them down.
That was pretty deep.
Whether that's an oops, deep. Tyler, or something intentional, we don't yet know.
That's what it said.
Let us know in chat.
I feel like something got lost.
Nope.
But I thought it was beautiful.
Yeah, I like
it's two spelled also, so it's probably what he meant. Guys, big question. Big question in the morning. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do with Johnny? Johnny is hogtied in the pantry. That's where you left him all night.
Yep. He's still there?
So the question of the day, I don't know, no one's opened the pantry door
yet. I'm going to go in and kick the door to the pantry.
You're going to kick the door to the pantry?
No, not like kick it, like knock it with my foot.
Oh, okay.
I was going to like, it's probably kind of a small pantry.
that's a different
visual
image.
I'm going to be like, wake up!
No response.
Oh, crap.
So we probably hear her do. I imagine we're all starting to congregate.
Yeah, James is outside. He passed tort law on the way in.
I have no consideration for anyone else. So if I don't even care if you were asleep.
We're picking up on that.
Yeah, so no answer?
No answer. And the pantry is just off the kitchen, which is just one door away from your bedroom, guys.
What are you doing in there, tort law?
Nothing. James! 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 James!
I'll come walking in those little swirl of pipe smoke, but...
Get out your gun and point it at this door.
Why?
Because I'm going to open it.
Ain't he hogtied?
Maybe.
All right.
Ready? And I open the door, but like real fast, it's where I'm standing back and like if anything flies out, it won't hit me.
Okay. Johnny is laying right where you left him, glaring balefully at the two of you.
Well, why didn't you say something when I knocked?
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't realize we were standing on politeness in this church, seeing as how I'm hogtied in my long johns. with the flap undone and have been left so all evening.
Oh, he probably has no feeling in any outer extremities right now.
Oh man, he is putting on a brave face, but every limb he has is asleep.
Yeah.
Limbs he didn't realize could go to sleep are asleep.
Okay, the false alarm.
Yeah.
Stand down.
All right, I'll go make sure that Gabe and Rosie are awake.
Okay, I go and I kneel next to him. And I say, do you want something for breakfast? Do you want to go relieve yourself?
You know, I don't think I'm going to dignify that with a response, because I imagine there's going to be some fresh humiliation attached to that. So instead, I will remain silent.
You remain silent by talking is what you're doing. That's fine. I'm going to go get something that tastes real good. I'm going to eat it in front of you. Hey, quick question. As long as we're here chatting, what kind of creature do you know of would explode a person and run away?
He just kind of stares at you impassively, but you can see the slightest quirk of his eyebrow as though he's not quite sure what to do with you. Mm. Guys, a toast.
Mm.
From Fawkwad.
Fawkwad.
Get ready. It's not as long as it was last time, but it's still a
Wait,
little
bit longer.
Did you
already start
it? Nope.
Oh.
Yeah, start memorizing this.
Okay.
To Marshal Teflon Neil Kallerman, Teflon may not be the best nickname, but it's probably better than Queasy Shitter Kallerman.
Okay.
To Marshal Teflon Neil Kallerman. Teflon may not be the best nickname, but it's probably better than Queasy Shitter Kallerman. Set him up, knock him down, but don't put him too far down. Because we have a correction.
Oh.
The real toast from the Bard 1971.
No kidding.
That wasn't right.
A toast to good friends who are like family. Mm. Yippee-ki-yay.
A toast to good friends who are like family.
Yippee-ki-yay! Set them up, knock them down. We're gonna break that shot glass, don't?
I don't think so.
Just you wait, just you wait.
You're like, that it's made for clinking.
Yeah.
All right.
That's its entire purpose in life.
So,
guys, I am wasted right now.
I can see it.
So much whisk tea. Torlaw is giving Johnny a hard time in the pantry. James, you walked into their room. How's it going, James?
We got to come up with a plan.
Oh, yeah, I think that's right. How much time do you think we have before the town starts gathering?
Well, sun just rose, so I don't think we have
much time. We need to figure out a way to utilize this man to bring the town more on our side. Well, we're doing good.
If we hadn't treated him so badly, we might have been able to get him a little more on our side, but that might be a little out of the question at this point.
I have a feeling his loyalty is pretty unwavering.
Can I roll to make him scream?
To make him scream?
Call out, like, cry out in pain in some way? Just in the middle of their thing?
What are you doing to him?
Don't you say it.
I don't know. Unspeakable horrors is what I'm going for.
Well, I mean, I need to know what it is so that I know what to make him roll.
She's playing Call of Cthulhu.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly.
Are you introducing him to knowledge man was not meant to know?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, I am.
So you're whispering things in his ear and trying to get
you're
him to
start? Turning into an owl in front of him, right?
No, that's not it at all. He's not cool enough for that. I'm collecting things.
Yet? I mean,
no.
I'm collecting things and seeing what I'm going to put.
Don't say it.
It's his mouth.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
I don't think that was better.
What you gonna gag him with? Cool. How are you trying to make him? Are you trying to like inflict pain on him to torture him in some way?
Yeah.
Okay.
Night Steve.
Thank you for the donation.
Like this is more conversation than I was going for.
Sure.
He's saying it's too bad we beat him. We can't win him over. At that time,
okay.
I am in the process of making him
not.
Just
let me know what you want to do to hurt him.
Yeah.
No, I get it.
What do you want to do to hurt him?
I want to make him eat a pine cone.
You brought a pine cone in from outside?
I ran out and grabbed one.
Okay.
Quick.
You're going to make him eat a pine cone. Okay,
yep.
Well, this is going to be an opposed roll because he's not going to open his mouth to eat a pine cone. So you're going to have to try and force him to open his mouth and force a pine cone into his mouth.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm going to open his mouth by pinching his nose.
So, okay. I mean, you can still
continuing to have like a planning conversation while you're like, you leave, come back with a pine cone, and just like
make an opposed strength roll
in the background.
Strength roll.
See this? Go back and forth.
All right. Strength roll after you.
Oh,
you aced it.
Okay, so
that's an eight. Okay, he got a three. So after a brief struggle, you pinch his nose and he gasps desperately and opens his mouth, at which point you shove a small, sharp pine cone?
Large, one of the ones that have really separated and it's real prickly.
Okay, we're near Sequoia. and you shove it into his mouth and he like just...
He's trying not to chew it and I'm like making him chew it. I'm like, eat your pine cone, and this isn't breakfast.
He is just like staring at you as tears well up out of the corner of his eyes and blood starts, I mean, you could probably hear her saying, eat your pine cone.
Does someone have eyes on Tartla?
But before that happens, I'm just like, perhaps we can still make a deal with him of some sort.
And then win him over.
We look in and you're just jamming a pine cone in his mouth, like, all right, well. It was just an idea.
Tartla, stop it! I want to go over and try and pull you away.
Well,
I am opposing this role.
James, could you get a towel or something for this poor man?
Wait, hold on. She's not letting pull her away.
Oh, so, okay.
Oppose strength rolls, guys. We want to present a united front to the townsfolk. You're kind of more focused on making him eat it. What'd you get?
A two?
You want to use any cursed Spanish gold?
Yes!
What?
Oh, thanks.
Oh, man.
Thanks so much. It's worse.
Good thing you got that rock
D6. Yeah, this cool die that
we
a bunch of us
cool
got.
We got cool stone D6s.
We'll see how well they work.
Okay, so as Rosaline tries ineffectually to pull Tortla off of Johnny
this
and stop
breakfast.
Him.
This is his breakfast!
Stop force feeding him a pine cone. Everyone raise a glass. Seems as appropriate a time to toast as any. This is from Christian Lindke. Let's get to hog tying.
Let's get to hog tying.
Set them up, knock them down. But don't put them too far down.
I'm like, should. Okay.
Final XP toast. This is the final XP toast. After this, toast will cost an increment of $5 each time, starting with five. This is from the infamous King Cupcake.
Oh, cupcake tastes so delicious.
Let's start the ultimate quest to rob the town's. Cool, folk? Is that supposed to be folk?
Folk, probably.
It's probably not cool blind. The town's cool blinds. Cool. Steal all the cool blinds from all the town. It's probably townsfolk.
Probably
I'm gonna go with townsfolk.
Folk, yeah.
Let's start the ultimate quest to rob the townsfolk blind.
Let's start the ultimate quest to rob the townsfolk blind.
Set them up, knock them down. And guys, Nightsteed has bought a fistful of cursed Spanish gold for the table.
Ooh. Nice.
So add
Thank you.
To the hoard.
For a few cursed gold more.
Yep. It's a good movie. All right, guys. So Rosaline and Tortla are struggling in the pantry while Johnny continues to eat his breakfast.
Tortla, this is a terrible breakfast for him.
It's good for him, trust me.
Well, Bulga,
you know I'm loath to suggest this, but I think maybe telling something of the truth might be the best way to go about here. If we just say we would rode out in the middle of the night, guided by forces above that of regular man, and found where they camped, were able to take out with our small force an entire band and bring him back unopposed. It looks good for us. Not as good as I would like, but...
Yeah, I have a feeling that when we bring this boy back into town, we're not going to be hailed as conquering heroes here. We definitely need to do something to get the town on our side.
There's nuts in it. It's protein.
Somehow we have to use this man as a weak link for the Holbrook gang. If we hold him hostage of some nature, that will hang him for all of his wrongs, they might hold back. And if they hold back, that could give us an opportunity to take them out once and for all.
You can sort of hear what they're talking about over the struggle in the pantry.
Tartla, if we could be a little nicer to him, we might be able to use him with the town. And I'm like yelling this at you. Tortla, listen to me!
It's your friend.
Tortla, what are you doing?
Everyone make a notice roll for me.
Uh-oh.
At a -2.
Oh, oh no.
Where's my notice? I don't like that.
All right. Dom, you got a 3.
Yep.
That is not a success, Dom.
You have a lot of cursed Spanish gold.
So what did I get?
Five. -2, that's also a 3. That is not a success. Oh, you're using cursed Spanish gold?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you so much.
I got a...
No, thank you.
One.
You got a 1? That is not a success.
No, it isn't.
Tordla? That is also not a success.
I'm probably...
Nope.
That one's not a success.
I think I'm gonna... Yeah.
You're gonna upset? Burrito Slayer 71. Thank you for the
follow. I love that TV show.
Are you? Yeah.
There you go.
Double sixes.
Okay. Six. 2 8s.
Okay.
-3.
I noticed.
Also
rerolling.
Oh.
Oh. Okay.
My God.
So I got a 6, basically.
The Rocky 6 word.
So somehow, despite the fact that you two are having a quiet conversation and they are struggling in the pantry over that, maybe they're just more keyed into what's happening while you guys are lost in conjecture. Mm-hmm. You hear a small, distant murmur from Coldwater Creek, as though people are starting to rouse and gather down in the streets.
Wait, Tart, do you hear that?
I heard that. They might be coming for us.
Gabe, James, I think they're coming.
All right.
No, to be clear, they're just following the plan that was set up the day before, where he told them to meet in the center of
town. I'm just telling them they're coming.
Okay.
Well, I believe that our time for discussing the plan is over. James, maybe we should swing this that you went out on your own. I'm a preacher here, and you too, Tort.
Thank you.
I'm just saying, if I'm the preacher and I'm trying to continue to keep myself looking like a man of God, going out and getting marauders in the night's not going to look good for me.
That's a fair point.
I'll take that, but why would we bring him back to the church instead of straight to the sheriff?
Sheriff was asleep.
Marshal, not elected.
All right,
official.
Walk out of town.
We have horses. We're
Don't
ride
go
out
right
of town.
To the center of town. Right out of town, a good couple hundred yards. I'll go to the center of town and say that if the man is not a coward, he will appear. You ride in, throw him down in the middle of town, and tell the story of your valiant capture of Johnny and his Holbrook gang.
But he could just tell them that we had him in the church all night. Unless, say, his mouth was full of pine cones.
Which you seem to have be far ahead of the game.
What if...
Wrapped in some kind of...
Knock him out as well.
What if you, preacher, were trying to show him the light? And I brought him here for a change of heart, perhaps.
Everyone gets a chance of redemption, all that. Yeah. I believe that'll read.
Try and save him, preacher.
All right, we don't have to actually do it.
What if he says you didn't actually do it? What if he says that we just fed him pine cones all
the murmur morning? Is building now to the point where those of you who didn't hear it before can now hear it. It does sound like quite a lot of townsfolk are gathering.
The hope is that the town will believe us and not him.
All right, let's go. Let's do it.
All right. In that case, what do we want to do? Would you like to come into town afterwards? I think it would be the better image.
Let's just walk down together. We'll be on horses. You guys be ahead. We'll be like... We tried to make a Christian out of him, but he's so sinnery.
You go in first. We'll ride in after.
I can handle this.
Do you want me to come with you, or should I follow?
I should probably be with him.
All right. I prefer that anyway.
You know I would always prefer to have you by my side.
As soon as she's gone, I can feed him more pine cones.
Tartla, it's not going to help us. You know James. Keep her from it.
All right. James.
All right, so you two are walking out from the front door of the church. Okay.
Mm-hmm. You know,
so you walk out and down in the in the newly bright town square, you can see quite a lot of townsfolk have turned out. There's a pretty big crowd here, even a little bit bigger than there was present last night when you asked for the town's mercy and not hogtie you guys outside of town. There's clearly word has spread, and they all at the opening of the church door, they all turn and look up at the hill. To watch you walk down towards them. There's a definite feel of excitement in the air.
Is it like everybody?
You don't know because you haven't met everybody yet, but it seems like Lot's body.
Lot's body.
Okay, so as I walk into town, I'm going to hold up my Bible and start saying a bit of the Lord's Prayer. Say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
I wish I was
He has delivered us from evil. Last night, as we slept, he granted a vision unto James Bogue. And the location of the Holbrook gang was revealed to us through the grace of God. And they fled like sinners in front of the wrath of an angry God. And we have for you today their leader, who has been a plague, a pox on this town, but no more. So I just walk in and...
That's a good speech, and they're all listening to it. Your voice, though no longer vocally unctioned, still carries quite nicely over the...
I'm still a charismatic motherfucker.
I'll tell you what, if you spend your best fate chip right now, we could have a sunbeam strike you as you're walking out of the church. I'm just saying, if it's worth it to you, you can give me that blue fate chip.
That matters very much to
okay.
me.
Okay. So as you are giving this sermon on your way down the hill and into the town, thank you for the donation.
Thank you.
The crowd just grows silent and just listens with rapt attention to you as you walk your way down, and you see some murmurs of agreement. And as you finish up your sermon and you raise your holy book high, a beam of sun just breaks over the mountains and illuminates you, almost cosmically perfectly as you walk out, and you hear just an excited murmur go through the town because they have heard. Many of them, of the miracle that you performed, calling down a fearsome demon from the Lord to scare the sinning Holbrook game away from the stagecoach. And this just solidifies
I imagine them. I'm kind of slightly behind him, and I just smile once I see that.
Yeah, I kind of like look up to the sky and mumble to myself, how the fuck did I do that?
I lean over to James say, I did that.
Right, well, we're still riding down. We're following them.
We haven't seen that?
Or from far away.
Feeding him pine cones.
So when you're finished, all the townsfolk down below, they go, well, preacher, what does that mean? They're all gone? The Holbrook gang is gone? And you captured one of them?
We have their leader, the man who came into town. We have the man who came into town and gave threats unto all of us villagers.
That ain't their leader. That's just Johnny. Well, hush up. He's still Holbrook's right hand. That does count for something.
The rest of them fled, but we have brought him to the church to attempt to talk him into the righteous path overnight. But now we have brought him here to face the justice of man.
Could you turn him, preacher? Did you make him see the light of the Lord?
There are some things that only God may do. And a man may appear to be turned on the outside and still be a sinner on the inside, as we all are.
Amen.
So it is only for God to judge if anyone has truly become righteous.
I like him. I think he's going to do really nice sermons.
As he's saying that, we'll ride on.
So you start. So they look up the hill and see you guys riding around. So you've loaded Johnny up onto the back of one of the horses.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Who's he behind? I assume
he's behind
you.
Me.
Yeah. Okay. That seems like a safe assumption.
Yeah.
And they gasp and talk excitedly. Like Johnny is no stranger to these folks. They've definitely dealt with his roughness before. He is bleeding slightly from the corners of his mouth. And is still slowly working small pine bits out of his teeth and spitting them disdainfully onto the ground along with the stream of blood. A couple people in the crowd go, "Why? Oh, he looks a bit roughed up. I thought that must be the preacher's rough friends. I don't know. I don't know why the preacher trucks with such rough individuals. Well, now he's new to town. We can't make any judgments." And as all this stuff is happening, you see Marshal Hurless step out from his office and just kind of lean up on the posts in front of it and just watch all of this occur from behind the gathered crowd. Hold on. Our donation from Bandana Man 95 is a piece of cursed Spanish gold to Tortla.
Thank you, sir.
To Gabriel.
Woo.
And Rosaline.
Why, thank you.
I guess they figured you had enough, James Bogue.
Guys, I only have 14.
And also a toast.
Oh. Ooh. Hurrah.
Pour your shot. We'll wait. To pine cone backwash.
to pine cone backwash.
Set them up. Knock them down. That whiskey burns so good.
All right. Came upon the frontier town of Pinecone Backwash.
So as Johnny comes riding down behind James Bogue and Tortlaw, the assembled crowd goes, what now? Preacher, what's the plan now? Ain't Holbrook going to come for him? Ain't he going to bring the rest of the gang?
God will protect us. As he has led us to get this man now, he will protect us in the trials to come. Now, they fled like scared children when we came upon them.
You know, they would. They're just a bunch of bullies.
And here in this town, we are tenfold more than that which we were last night. And I believe that there is no gang that can combat those who are blessed by the Lord.
You hear a scoffing sound from the marshal back behind the gathered crowd, but apart from that, he offers nothing.
Preacher, it sounds like the marshal has something to say.
Well, men of little faith often have many words.
That's true.
I was merely wondering what it is you plan to do. What? Oh, yeah, that's good. That's good. I'm just being louder. With this Johnny Carrington, now that you have him. What is the plan here? Oh, illustrious preacher, please do guide your flock.
Well, as a preacher deals with the laws of God, it is the job of a marshal to deal with the laws of man.
Oh, I see. So it is that I am to lock up this outlaw and call down the wrath of the full brunt of his leader and his leader's men upon Coldwater Creek?
What is it that you should do, Marshal? Isn't that your job?
It is. But as this is still a growing town, I think the wiser course of action would have been to have done what I had suggested and send for aid from either the Texas Rangers or the U.S. Marshal.
No one stopped you from doing that.
No. Instead, you acted rashly and went out on your own as vigilantes to take down Johnny.
It just
Johnny.
Seemed like you needed a bit of help.
When were you going to call those rangers, Marshal?
I offered to call them today, last night, to all the townsfolk assembled. Said it'd take but a mere handful of weeks for them to offer us aid.
And you wanted to sacrifice some of us here in the town
beforehand. I remember that. I was here last night, and that is what he said. It didn't seem like a good plan then, and it doesn't seem like one now. And the Marshal just kind of seems
seem
a bit cowed.
To have confidence in you, Marshal.
You guys can hear the jangling of spurs.
Uh-oh.
From behind you. It sounds, all of a sudden, just seems to have caught a silent moment from the assembled crowd. And you all turn.
Ooh, BSB Care.
Thank you for the donation. And watch as a stranger walks into town.
Oh, no.
Now, this woman seems like a strong woman. She's young, she seems hale and hearty. She always has a smile on her face. But it never seems to touch her eyes. And she says, well, it seems as though I've walked right into the middle of a bit of a difficult situation. She kind of moves her jacket to the side, although, as pictured, her badge is going to be on her hat. And you all see a Texas Ranger badge displayed very prominently for all to see. Is anyone watching Johnny at this point? Anyone have eyes on Johnny?
Yeah,
you probably don't.
Yeah. He's still in the back.
He's behind you, yeah. But you can't see him. Tor, you might be the only person who would see him at this point.
I would be watching for an opportunity.
At the appearance of this woman and the flashing of her badge, the color drains from Johnny's face.
Oh, finally.
And he gets, for the first time, he looks a bit afraid. Now, it seems like you've got a little bit of a situation here. Who is this man? To me, he looks like Johnny Carrington. But that's just because, as a Texas Ranger, it is, of course, my job to be intimately familiar with all people wanted by the Confederate States of America.
You are quite right. It is Johnny.
I thought so. Now, Marshal, what was it that you were just saying to these fine folks who done got this this outlaw for you?
Quick.
Well, ma'am, I was just saying that, maybe it wasn't the wisest course of action is all I'm saying. Oh, I see. Well, Marshall, maybe you and I should have a conversation inside of your office, and maybe, if you folks would oblige, you could bring Mr. Carrington inside as well, and the three of us could have a good long talk. See, I intend to be staying here for just a little while. I'm on the lookout for a few kind folk. So I think, Marshall, you and I might have quite a few words to exchange if it's all the same to you. And he seems a bit cowed. In fact, the entire crowd has gotten a bit hushed at the appearance of this. Now, you guys would all know this. The Texas Rangers are the elite of the Confederate States. Mm-hmm. They only typically send one of them at any given point because their motto and creed is one riot, one ranger.
Would we be worried?
Oh, I don't know. One of you might be.
I think.
Okay, but that's what I'm trying to figure out.
And as
if that's the case, then I would probably have sort of edged my way in front of him.
Sure. You'd edge in front of him?
A little bit. Not noticeably, but just enough to...
Is it not noticeably?
Nope, it's yeah. I am so good at edging.
Let's see. Let's see how noticeable.
Roll not being noticed one.
Yeah, what do I...
Well, yeah, okay, so this would be a stealth roll.
Uh-oh.
And guys, at this point, we have unlocked the second tier reward.
Ooh. What?
A deadly promotion.
Oh, I don't... That sounds
a deadly
thank
promotion.
You guys.
Sounds bad. That sounds
not
like dying.
Domination.
All right.
Four.
Yeah, you might want.
Mm-hmm. Does that mean I need to use some Spanish gold?
I mean, you could.
Well,
maybe I will.
Okay. So you're rolling against a five.
Yeah, it's gonna be great. Look at this. There's my five.
Okay.
Do I need that? Do I need to go higher?
I mean, you're trying to be stealthy.
I know.
I'm just going to spend this piece of cursed Spanish gold real quick. To keep a five. Don't worry, guys. I think I'm just going to spend this other piece of cursed Spanish gold real quick.
Where do these keep coming from?
I have a whole clown car thing going on back here. Ooh, I wish that had been
that
in the tray.
That would have been.
Oh, no, guys. I'm going to have to spend this other piece of cursed Spanish gold.
Hey!
See the sour cream.
There's your six.
I'll stand on that. You going to spend one?
Whew!
And this is the game right here, guys. It's a gold off.
Spanish gold off.
Oh, I don't want to keep doing this, but I really don't want to
what
fuck
about,
this up.
No.
No.
I mean, you could use the, you could add.
These? Oh, that's true.
Yeah, you could add a D6. Well, not to that, I wouldn't bother adding it.
With this one?
So you're going to spend a blue fate chip to add a D6 to that roll?
I don't know. I don't know if this is a good use of this.
What's going on anymore?
Okay.
Okay. Now I have a seven.
A seven? Okay. Cool. Now, this Texas Ranger is a wild card,
so
I get fate chips for her as well, so I'm just going to draw these
wonderful.
Two.
Okay.
Oh, look at that. It's a blue fate chip.
Hey.
I'm going to spend that to add a D6 to this roll.
Amazing.
Nope. Lommeled
it.
Failed.
Woo.
That's an eight.
Damn. Wait, what? I used a lot of Spanish gold.
I mean,
I hate to just like counter what you're doing, but since it doesn't seem to quite be working, can I just like step out from behind her? And...
Yeah. Okay. So what ends up happening is it's noticed that you're trying to move in front of him. So you're trying to step out of the crowd.
But it's not. I'm just moving. It's not like you can tell I have intentions.
The Texas Ranger can.
Yeah. Rose. Now I understand that. People with guns, it is your instinct to keep me protected from that, but there's no need. This woman is here to help our kind town. He walks right up to the Texas Ranger and is just like, good madam, Ranger, we are...
You could call me Ranger Wynn.
Ranger Wynn.
Esther Wynn to all of you townsfolk assembled. I'm sure I will be getting to know each and every one of you.
Ranger Wynn, I'd just like to say how blessed we are. When we thought we would have to wait weeks... For the aid of the Texas Rangers in accosting this here criminal. But you have been granted to us by God.
We do come when we are needed, that's true. It's a pleasure to meet you, Preacher.
It's Gabriel. Gabriel Pryor.
Sure it is. And she gives you a knowing look.
I smile back and nod and I say, if you're staying in town, I would welcome you at our congregation on Sunday.
Oh, I'm sure I will make it up there one of these days, for sure.
Well, I'll be looking forward to it.
Likewise. All right, Marshall, shall we retire? And you could just pick up Mr. Carrington here, just hold him by the hog tie.
Esther Wynn?
Yes?
I know Esther Wynn.
Oh, Dom is using his adventure deck card.
Wow.
He's using contact. Your hero sees an old friend or acquaintance who might help him in his current quest somehow. Masterful use of that card.
Well done.
Very nice.
James Bogue.
Esther Wynn.
As I live and breathe. Let's keep saying each other's first names at each other for a little bit.
Ranger.
What are you doing out here?
Oh, you know, this and that.
I ain't seen you since.
Yeah?
Where was the last time we saw each other, James?
Oh, I think it was that Union prison camp.
That it was. So days I try to forget.
You're a ranger now, huh?
I am.
What brings you around these hair pots?
Oh, you know, this and that.
Yep. So, what you got on Johnny here?
What?
What you got on Johnny?
Just a bounty. You could walk right inside this here marshal's office and see his wanted poster.
This is my bounty.
Oh, are you claiming it?
Well, I got him.
Marshal, you didn't mention that these fine folk were turning in Mr. Carrington for the bounty. You should pay the nice people. And the marshal just kind of looks at you. Just kind of adjusts his coat. Yeah. I will, I'll make sure to get that payment right to you, Mr. Bogue.
Much obliged, Marshal. Esther, it would help us out a lot to know what you have planned for Mr. Carrington. This Holbrook gang that we understand is plaguing this town is probably going to come back and try and get this Mr. Carrington.
James, I understand where you're coming from. And we will talk about that at some point, but for the time being, I have pressing business to attend to. But I will be seeking you out later on. I'm sure we have a lot to catch up on.
I look forward to it.
Alrighty. So nice seeing you again, James.
Likewise, Esther.
We're on a first name basis.
Yeah. I'm sorry, what were their names again?
And she walks inside the marshal's office, followed by the marshal. And Johnny gives all of you one last look that lingers on Tortlaw as he is pulled inside of the marshal's office.
Right. I think you have a young admirer, Tortlaw.
That's what it looks like to me. I blow him a kiss. Because I look forward to seeing him again in a hogtied situation.
Sure you will.
I know this is just a table thing, but I just want to point out how masterfully I just
he figured it out.
I did poured a whole beer in there all at once?
Into this he did. In one go.
Took us 20 minutes last time. Well
it
done.
Was real hard.
Well done.
And I've got it now.
Tyler, was there a donation up here that you took down that I didn't hit? BSB Cares donation?
You can control Z it.
Oh, shit, you're right.
Did I hit that?
Nope, that was me.
Okay, BSB Care. Is this a toast?
It could be.
It was $12, which is a strange amount.
There's Modelo.
It was a donation out of
the
kindness of his own heart.
Oh, thank you very much, BSB Care. So that was
wonderful.
That was. We can toast him for
just,
that.
Yeah, we'll do a toast for that. So BSB Care donated just because. Because Marshal Jordan and Deputy Tyler are doing a good job tonight. And don't overlook Deputy Isaiah. He's our newer deputy, but he's also doing a great job back there, guys.
Junior deputy.
We'll call him Scooter. All right, guys. This is just a toast to BSB Care. To BSB
Care.
Set him up. Knock him down. Get whisk tea everywhere. Ruined.
Damn it, BSB Care!
I have more, too.
So the gathered crowd...
Did you splash on Tortlaw?
I think it would improve Tortlaw's demeanor.
Oh, it might.
The gathered crowd, guys, seems a bit disappointed. I think they were expecting some sort of dramatic pronouncement or something of that, but to have the wind sort of stolen out of their sails by the sudden appearance of a Texas Ranger is a bit anticlimactic to them. But they all... go, okay, well, I guess, yep, that's settled. I mean, Texas Rangers are here now, so everything's under control. We should just go about our day. Preacher, we'll see you on Sunday for the sermon.
What day is today?
I'll see you then.
Today? Why, today is Wednesday day.
I was back when they called it Wednesday
day. Well, it's Christmas day. I haven't missed it.
And they all start to disperse, except for one who comes stalking sulkily down the street.
Oh, no.
Oh, boy.
Accompanied by four of his friends who all are looking at him a bit guardedly. He comes walking right up. This is Boyd Parker. This is the young man that you humiliated in front of the entire town last night in a gunfight when you fired a warning shot totally on purpose, not because you rolled a low damage roll and scared him off and demonstrated your prowess. He comes walking right up to you and he says, hey, that is to say, hello, Mr. Bogue and friends. Listen, I just wanted to say that I realized my behavior last night was reprehensible and unexcusable. I am a bit of an angry drunk, and I apologize for that. My friends informed me that I was quite unforgivable, and that, in fact, I almost perished at your hands. And I'd like to say thank you for not killing me. And I just wanted you to know, Mr. Bogue, friends, preacher,
well, aren't
miss,
you sweet?
That should you need any help in town ever, you got me and my boys to back you up. And I just wanted to say that. So that's all. And thank you.
I think you made some friends.
And he sort of like just shame blushes and turns around and stalks back down the street and his friends go with him. That was because last week, Boyd and his boys were unlocked by chat. That was a tier reward from last week.
Nice.
As was One Riot, One Ranger, which brought a Texas Ranger into the town of Coldwater Creek. So thank you, chat,
thank
for
you.
Introducing further wrinkles into the plot of Coldwater Creek.
I was a little worried when I heard Boyd and his boys.
Yeah.
I know.
Oh, great.
You never know which direction I'm going to go.
Yeah, no,
it's crazy.
Crazy.
All right, so the townsfolk have just kind of dispersed. There's no excitement to be had here today. They seem to have all forgotten that the threat of Colt Holbrook coming to town and exacting his revenge is not too far off. In fact, you guys have no idea when or if he might strike. But for the time being, you've been granted a bit of a reprieve.
Well, I feel like that went better than maybe we could have hoped. I think.
Well, perhaps. I think perhaps we should take that bit of good luck and go find another boomtown to fleece.
Yes. Although you seem to know this ranger, which maybe we can use somehow. But
yeah, a lot of people seem to know each other.
Right.
In that.
I don't want to leave yet. There's still an explodey creature here.
That to me is another good reason to get out of town.
I would agree with Gabe on that one. And at the end of the day, if
that
he's in danger.
A bit unsettling, I will admit. But if we need anyone on our side, it's this Esther Wynn.
I've got a good feeling that she's not here to be on our side.
She might be on your side. I don't know if she's on our side.
Well, maybe we can work something out.
Do you know her well enough to feel like you could swear if it came to it?
I haven't seen her in a number of years, but we did go through some interesting times together.
That means they hooked up.
Bantana Man 95, thank you for the donation.
Thank you.
Bantana Man.
Well, if we stay and we deal with this woman, it's going to be on you to help protect Gabe.
I understand.
So you guys haven't had a whole lot of time to actually spend in Coldwater Creek. It's been sort of nonstop since you got here. So everyone make a notice roll for me real quick, just to look around and observe these people in their day-to-day life.
Great, that's a four.
Four, that's a success.
Go ahead.
Wow.
That's critical failure.
Can I?
You want to re-roll it? I'll tell you,
you
right
think
now.
I should?
I'm not going to critically punish you for. You're not going to.
That's what I'm worried about.
You're not going to get sand in your
There's
eye.
A gun to your head.
You're blind.
Get my knife.
Okay. You just stabbed me to death.
Oh no!
Let's get this over with.
Two and a three.
Critical failure.
Yeah. I don't nail this anything.
It'd be very bad.
It's a five.
All right, so that's a success from James Bogue and Gabriel Pryor. Also, Dom.
Yeah.
So. Draw.
Ah.
This is from Bandana Man 95. Just don't actually pull the trigger. That's his request.
Because okay. You said draw, and then
right. Yeah, no, it's a pun.
Do you want? Okay, no.
Take a card, Dom. What'd you get?
Villainous verbosity.
Oh,
that's a good one.
Play to make an opposing wild card lose his next action by gloating or talking about his master plan.
Oh, that's good.
Nice.
That's a really good one.
That's awesome.
Thank you very much, Bandana Man. That was awesome.
All right. So you two. You two just kind of know, like, you just sort of take it in. There's a lot of hustle and bustle. As you noticed when you first arrived in town yesterday, there's industry here. There's a lot of growth and building, and there's new people coming in all the time. You two notice what looks like a group of children running around through town. You notice them because they stand out for a couple of reasons. A, they are not dressed like the rest of the townsfolk. They're dressed somewhat garishly. And also, they're hanging up a bunch of, like, flyers and posters all over town. that looking in the opposite direction that they are now heading, you can see they've all but wallpapered every storefront and shopfront and building on the way up with at least a couple of these flyers.
Do we see what's on those flyers?
You could walk over and check one out.
I think I'm going to do that.
Okay. So you walk over and check out one of these flyers, which proclaim that a special act has rolled into town. Sally Trenton and her marvelous ARC, spelled A-R-Q, a traveling steam wagon and burlesque show, a marvel of modern science and titillation. Limited engagement in Coldwater Creek, a few nights only, starting tonight, just after dark, just outside town. And there is a picture of a rather coquettish woman standing in front of some sort of steam engine contraption that looks like it might fold into a stage.
Have you seen this before? Seen these this act?
I've heard rumors of things like this going on out here, well, with the Ghost Rock and all, but I've never seen anything like it myself.
Quite interesting. We might have to go check it out just to see what it's all about.
Make sure we don't have any competition.
Right? That's very important.
We do have other business at hand, as Holbrook is going to come into town.
Which I think is another great reason for us to not be in town when it happens.
There's an explodey monster to meet.
Right.
You are just playing right into my statement.
You really are, Tartar.
I don't really understand why you are not interested in explodey monsters.
I would say I'm interested in the same way that you are interested in the gun that is pointed at your head at any given moment.
It makes things interesting. It's what? Fun.
I can't argue with you there.
I have an idea. Let's go to the alley where I found the body before and see if there's anything still there.
I suppose we could do that.
Yeah.
But I'm sort of with James. I'm a bit worried about this Holbrook. Seems like it could happen at any time.
Then let's be ready.
All right, so a few things to check out, and you have the day. You've got this strange traveling show that has rolled into town that will be doing its first performance tonight. You've got the alleyway where the strange pile of rotten meat was discovered, and the shoes and the hat. And you have all this strangeness with Holbrook. Everything's strange. What do you guys want to do with your day?
Well, I feel like we should start getting our bearings of the town, start talking to some people, or at least I could do that, and try and figure out who we can get on our side, who we need on our side. Maybe see if we can find anything about the Baron here in town.
Yeah. I was going to say, I want to try and see if I can, like, find a small child in the town and maybe bribe them to follow the Texas Ranger around and just, like, bring back anything they say.
Okay. All right, so that's what you want to do?
Yeah.
Okay, why don't we do it like this? What does everybody want to do with their day? You can partner up, you can go your own ways. This is your modus operandi when you move into town. So you two are looking for ways to set up your con, I assume, or get the lay of the land. What is it that you guys do when you roll into a new place?
Well, I'm gonna try and find any information that I can. If anyone's heard of the Baron, or if there's any sort of connection with this Baron. When I heard about the whole, and I tell you guys, when I heard this Holbrook gang, where there's gangs, there's usually the Baron. I can feel his fingers here.
That's an interesting point. As Johnny was being pulled into the marshal's office, knowing that he was about to go in to deal with the Texas Ranger, he looked a bit different to you, actually. Make a smarts roll for me. Because the first time you saw him, when his scar was revealed, you had a flash of recognition but couldn't place it. So make a smarts roll.
Four?
It's a four?
Mm-hmm.
That's a success.
Hey, nice deed.
Nice deed. Thank you for the donation. Seeing him like that, not confident, not full of swagger, he looked fearful, vulnerable, a bit younger even. And it puts you in mind of a time before when you might have seen him, actually, and it suddenly connects for you in your head that Johnny Carrington used to run with Adrian Meek. Now, Adrian Meek, you would know as one of the Baron's underbosses. They called him the Bear.
Oh, yeah.
He was a huge, huge wall of a man that preferred to do all of his killing with his bare hands, which is where his nickname came from. It was a double entendre.
I see.
And Johnny, at that point, was a young upstart who was answering to him, you know, just like a fresh young brigand. Mm-hmm. But suddenly you connect, you make that connection.
You know, it's all coming back to me. This Carrington boy, he used to run with one of those underbosses that the Baron had, the Bear. I don't know if you've ever run into him.
Oh, the Bear. Man.
Tortlaw, I think you helped me track him down at one point.
Oh. A dude named Bear. No, I don't know him.
Yeah, okay.
She's tracked so many bears and men named Bear. It's hard to remember.
Bear.
Hey, Talene, how are your reflexes?
My reflexes.
Draw!
Oh.
This is from Night Steed. Dom, don't just put the
don't,
gun
don't
down.
Don't really Dom. Draw.
It's just a little. You got a new
All right, what do you got?
Missed me. Now it's my turn. Play after any other character's attack roll to cause it to automatically fail. This is a critical failure.
That is, in fact, the card that save your life when Johnny Carrington had you dead to rights.
This is my friendly card. This is my best friend card.
Save his life now.
All right. Now you're carded up. Thank you very much, Nightsteen. I look forward to dealing with that. All right, guys. So you make that recognition.
Okay.
Tortlaw, what do you want to do in town?
Here's what I would do.
Please, hit me with it.
I would go into a general store. The biggest store in town, I would find the most unlikely item in there that I would ever want to own.
Okay.
And then I would tie up a clerk for about 2 hours, asking questions, contemplating.
Guys, she didn't mean literally tie up.
Yeah.
She didn't mean, we all thought
really
literally tie up.
Oh,
she meant,
okay.
She meant figuratively tie up.
Did you see everyone else at the table go,
like, oh, God.
She's going to tie up a clerk?
We're going to have to leave now.
Okay, so
realize you took the hindrance psychopath.
You're going to erstwhile occupy a clerk.
I'm
going
to occupy this person for a couple of hours. I'm sorry that I didn't even occur to me that I can no longer use tied up metaphorically.
Nope.
Afterwards, I'm going to find that little old lady who was questioning the preacher when we first came in.
Oh, man. Was it Irma and Mabel? Were those their names?
I don't remember.
Was it Prudence Beecher?
No, not Prudence Beecher. She's the preacher's biggest fan. She's the one who called for him.
Okay.
No,
that's who I'm talking about.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Prudence.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
The school teacher.
Yes. She's not a little old lady?
No, she just acts like a little old lady.
Oh.
She's a spinster.
But we've met other little old religious ladies.
You
who
met
like,
two little
I like
old religious
ladies. I want to find those two ladies.
Okay, those are, we'll say Irma and Mabel. We'll go with
okay,
that.
Irma and Mabel.
It's canon.
Irma and Mabel. Mabel. I'm going to find them wherever they are. I'm going to approach them as though I am very drunk,
okay,
staggering around, and then I'm going to fall on them, and then I'm going to tell them a long story about how I am lost in my life, and I have no faith. And I've killed lots of people, and I really regret it. And man, I wish I could be saved by someone. And when they try to, like, if I'm gonna make them want to save me, and they're like, "No, no, you can't," and then I'm gonna leave.
Okay.
All right.
I would love to make you role play all of that, but I feel like you just did, kind of. So, good, good. I think that sounds like a great way to spend a day.
And then I'm gonna go to that alley.
Okay.
And see if there's meat there.
Okay. So at this point, you're beginning your plan to tie up a store clerk for 2 hours, trying to purchase, we'll say, a butter churn.
Yes.
So you're going to be asking him a lot of questions about the specifications of the butter churn. This is down in the general store.
Yeah.
And there's really only the one clerk there, so you have his undivided attention as he tells you everything there is to know about this latest model butter churn. Then we'll check back with you in a little bit, because that's going to be a good 2 hours. So where are you two heading? You're trying to find a little kid?
Well, first thing you do, is
boy or girl?
To find a little boy.
Little boy?
I'd say. And I might find one or two kids.
Okay.
And basically just, like, offer that, you know, go to them and just be like, child, come here. Speak to me for a moment.
Oh, sure. Hi, preacher.
Sorry,
we's just playing in the street. That ain't against religion, is
no,
it?
No.
Okay,
no,
okay.
Please, be merry. I like speaking with innocents like you, because you don't have the taint of the world on you like us.
Like us older people do.
Yeah, okay.
But when new people come into town, why trying to keep my flock clean, it can be very difficult.
Oh, sure, yeah, that makes sense.
And it would just mean so much to me if you could just keep an eye on that new lady who's coming to town, that nice Texas Ranger.
Oh, the Texas Ranger.
And just let me know anything that she might need, anything she is here looking for, or any sins I might have to help her work through. And I would be happy to give you this crisp $10 bill.
Holy crap.
Wow.
Hold on. Bandana Man, thank you for the donation.
You. Thank you.
Now, a $10 bill.
I know it's a lot.
That's $260 in modern day money.
Oh, okay. Maybe that's more than I realized.
Just so you guys know, for reference, a cavalry soldier makes $17 a month.
Okay, so I won't give him $10, even though I've got a decent amount of money left.
You would change this kid's life if you gave him a $10 bill.
He buys a mine.
All right, I'll give him a dollar. I'll offer him a dollar and say that if you do your job well enough, why, there may be more.
More?
The Lord giveth.
More dollars?
Well, I can't promise anything.
He doesn't know the second half of that.
I'm merely a humble preacher. But those who do the good work that is given to them are rewarded by the Lord.
Well, a preacher, yeah, I could do that. I could keep an eye on the Texas Ranger lady and see if she needs anything. Should I ask her if she needs anything
and say
the preacher wanted to know?
No, don't bother her. No. She has a lot on her plate.
Yeah, she's busy, yeah.
We are just here to make sure that this town is exactly what she needs it to be.
Okay, sure. I will do the best job anyone has ever done, preacher.
Anything she says to the good marshal,
okay,
we all know may be a little lacking in faith, just tell me.
Okay.
And I will make sure that her needs are met,
preacher,
in this town.
I should probably listen, because not everybody likes to talk about what it is they need around other people. So I could listen at the window and see if she mentions anything she might need, and then I could let you know and you could surprise her.
Now, I believe that you are a smart child.
Thanks.
And I'll throw in an extra shiny nickel just for for your good ideas.
Thank you, preacher. Hey, by the way, Gabriel, draw!
Whoa!
This is from Bandana Man 95.
Bandana Man. All right, Turncoat, how much are they paying you? Your hero somehow convinces or bribes a minor foe to perform a small favor, such as helping the hero escape, revealing the location of the boss, etc.
That's perfect.
I'm definitely taking that one over the teamwork one.
All right, turn it into teamwork. Teamwork is for suckers.
Teamwork is great, but that's right up my alley, I think.
Thank you, Bandana Man 95. Also, tier 3 has been unlocked.
Wow!
So thank you guys for unlocking that. We only have the stretch tier left.
Ooh,
So you guys rock. Thank you guys. Seriously. I will not announce the title of tier 3 at this point.
I want to point out that the bad guy on here is the Iron Baron.
Really? Wow. Nice.
That's the name of the bad guy?
That's the name of the
bad
guy.
Well, now you have to hold that card, because that's like the name of the guy you're trying to find, except for the iron part.
How I did it. By the Iron Dragon.
KBTLR 1973, thank you for the follow.
Thank you.
Kibitalur.
All right, so this is Presley Riddle.
Riddle.
This is the young boy. We'll say he's an 8-year-old boy that you have swayed to your side with promises of dollars and shiny nickels. And he runs off in the direction of the marshal's office. So you're down $1.05. Keep track of your change, guys.
Yeah. All right.
All right, Rosaline, what are you up to?
Well,
$25.95.
Rosaline is going to just kind of stroll through town, just
okay.
kind of smiling at everyone she passes, specifically the men, but the women too.
As you pass the general store, you hear a barrage of questions floating out from Tortlaw. Tortlaw, what are you asking the nice man at the general store about this butter churn?
So, the volume of this butter that produced by this butter churn,
yes,
as opposed to other butters, would it be a fluffier butter?
Well,
or could I get a denser butter?
I can't rightly say. You continue on past the general store.
I just kind of shake my head when I hear her in there. So basically what I want to do is I want to wander around and see if I can get an idea of where people are hanging out, where like the businessmen tend to be, the people who are running the mines, not so much the people who are working in them, but I want to see if I can find either if it's a saloon or if there's like a particular club or there's somewhere where...
So you spend a little time wandering the streets of Coldwater Creek, mm-hmm. and you notice there's the main saloon that's on Main Street. It seems to be the nice one. That's the one you guys have already frequented, the Laughing Lady. Mm-hmm. You also see there is a second saloon a little off on one of the side streets that seems to be a bit seedier. There's a lower class of clientele there.
Okay.
So whereas the general townsfolk seem to congregate at the Laughing Lady, the Saddle Burr seems to attract a slightly lower class of people. These seem to be more of the vagrants, the rough and tumble types. And there's not quite as many people here. It's a smaller establishment.
So
you notice that in passing.
It's still morning, right?
Yeah, at this point, the day is moving
so
on, sure.
How, just kind of peeking into both of these saloons, how many people are in them currently?
I mean, at this point, there's not a whole lot in any of them since it's still somewhat early in the day, but there's a few people hanging out in the Laughing Lady. There's maybe two or three in the Saddle Burr.
Okay.
But none of these places seem to be where the upper crust might congregate. Now, just looking through the town, you can see that there is one building here that stands out very much from the rest.
Oh, yeah, what building is that?
That is what looks like almost a manor house built a bit further back into town.
Oh. So it's not like an office building?
It is not. No, it seems to be a private residence.
Hmm.
And it has a nice wrought iron gate lining the property around it.
Does there seem to be any particular, are there any particular... places of business that seem to maybe be where the mine, like where someone who owned a mine would be?
I mean, there is the Harris Mining Company building.
Mm-hmm. Would I know, I mean, would I have any knowledge? I assume there are multiple mines here.
There are multiple mines, but you found out the first day you were in town that Carlton Harris is the one who owns that's the mine where Ghost Rock was first discovered.
Right.
He's the primary mining magnate.
So I want to go into that.
Into the mining company?
Yeah, into the mining company. And I'm going to go in and just kind of look worried and just go, who's in there?
There's just like a clerk working behind a desk
male
in the
female.
Front room. Roll a d4 for me.
A d4.
Odds it's male, evens it's female. It's a female.
All right.
Sorry to disappoint you.
It's okay. No, I can use that too. So I go in and just looking kind of worried and I go, oh, I'm so sorry. I'm so desperately lost. I don't know where I am. I'm trying to find my way back to the church. And I just thought, could you point me in a direction?
Oh, sure, miss. Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. How rude of me. What is your name?
Oh, hi. Viola.
Viola.
Yeah, I'm the clerk here at the mining company.
Oh, you're the clerk? This is the mining company.
Yeah, Harris Mining Company says so on the sign out front.
Oh, I'm so... flustered. I just missed it. Of
sure.
course it is. Wow. Well, are you working on it? I'm so fascinated by the mining. I don't know anything about it. I'm from Boston. I've not heard much about it.
Oh, you're that lady that came in with the preacher.
I am. Yes, I just arrived.
Oh, sure. Yeah. No, I could tell you how to get back to the church. I know it's
kind
of a big town. You can get turned around.
Oh, so easily. I don't know how you find your way.
You guys notice, just in general, all the townsfolk, even the general store clerk, who at this point, you're really trying his patience, they seem to be reacting very positively to you. It's almost as if your reputation precedes you.
What?
And word of your deeds has spread a quite favorable reputation through the town. They're being very friendly with you.
Nice.
Almost to a man. Sure, so you're just gonna wanna go outside and you're gonna turn around and just walk all the way back down Main Street, and the church will be up on the hill right at the entrance to town. You can't miss it.
Of course, I should have realized that. Well, do you mind if I sit here for a bit? It's quite hot today.
Oh, sure, yeah. No, it is a little unseasonably warm.
Right? What's that about? Is that typical for this part of the country?
I don't rightly know, miss. I've only been here for probably about 6 months, so it was
winter
when I got here, and now it's supposed to be spring, but it don't feel like it.
Oh, no, it quite doesn't.
No.
So, you work here at the front. Do you ever work with... Who would you say this was? The Harris Mining Company?
Yeah, Carlton Harris. He owns the big mines.
Do you ever work with him?
Mr. Harris comes in from time to time. He prefers to do most of his business from his home.
Oh, where is his home then?
Oh, right. You're new to town. So you're going to go outside and you'll turn the opposite direction of the church and you'll see a big old building in the back. Looks like a manor. It's got a nice wrought iron gate around it.
That's Mr. Harris's house.
Oh.
That, oh, they, oh, I'm sorry. He calls it Harris Manor. So that's where he lives.
Of course.
He prefers to do his business from there, but he'll come into the office from time to time, and I'll say, hello, Mr. Harris. Here is your paperwork.
So he just stays in his manor house all the time?
Most of the time, yeah.
He doesn't come out and mingle with the townsfolk?
No, he ain't much for mingling.
Really?
Yeah.
Bit of a hermit then. Well, that must be strange to
work
for.
Well, he's an important man. You know, he's got important things on his mind.
Well, you know, since I'm new to town, I'm still looking for a job. How did you get this one?
Oh, I saw as they put a sign up in the window saying that they needed help. And I said, well, shucks, Viola, you could do that.
Of course
you could.
You
help.
Could.
So I applied, and I was accepted to the position.
Oh, well, congratulations.
Thank you. So I'd recommend following a procedure much like that.
Oh, that's... You have been so helpful today.
Well, you've been very nice.
Oh, well, thank you. I appreciate you letting me talk at you.
Your dress is very pretty.
Oh, I thank you. Sure. I'm very proud of this one.
Sure.
Well, it was lovely talking to you. Thank you for the directions, and hopefully I'll be seeing you around town.
Nice talking to you. All right, Bogue. So you figure that out about Johnny. What do you want to do? And then I'll give you all a chance to do one more rapidy fiery thing.
Whoa.
Before we jump ahead.
I'm gonna, you know, I didn't get a great eye on this town.
Sure.
So I'm a cautious man. So.
You are. It's one of your hindrances, in fact. Cautious to a fault.
I'm basically looking at all entrances, exits, potential places where men could be placed, things of that nature, almost to a military precision.
Okay.
I just want to look at the town and find, okay, where I could be, where someone else might be.
Sure.
Things like that.
So the way the town is set up, by the church, coming past the church is how folks get into town. Heading down the road further takes you up to the mountain and up to the mines and all the different various claims and all that kind of stuff. So there really only is one way into town.
Okay.
You know from experience last night that there is a bunch of hills and forest out there that could be utilized by outlaws like it was. It does kind of funnel down at this point through the hills and the mountains into the main road that comes into town. So really the church is like the foremost lookout point.
Okay.
Of both directions in the town.
Great, okay.
And that's... you see several places, like above the hotel, there's a second floor where there's a balcony that leads outside. On top of various buildings, you see a second story that looks accessible. Maybe on top of the saloon, it looks like there might be one just on the front, not on the sides,
okay.
Where men could be posted up.
Okay, good to know.
So you get the lay of the land of the town. You kind of walk around doing that. At this point, you're almost, the clerk is like, sure, he's got you pegged down for a buy. How do you disengage?
Well, I'm going to have to think this one over.
Okay. And you say that for a while, and he just looks at you. Do you stand there thinking it over?
Yeah.
He looks nervously around at the other customers who seem to need his help.
Yep. I don't really like butter. Bye.
Oh, okay. And you just leave.
Yeah, I just leave.
Him standing there, just bewildered. Mm-hmm. And you see Irma and Mabel walking down the street. And we continue on to that bit.
Yes.
All right, so one more rapid thing before we move the time along. What are you doing after? After recruiting a small spy, what's your next move?
I guess after recruiting a small spy, I go around town and I want to buy just a couple items of clothing and stuff that basically I'm making kind of a bug out bag. So like if I had to, I could look like someone pretty different.
Okay.
Like I buy like a razor and some new shoes, new pants, like all that kind of thing.
Okay.
Some various stuff that I could use as like padding to make myself look like fatter or something. And I just kind of casually try and not buy it all at one place kind of deal.
Okay.
But just kind of do all that and then stow it at the church.
Well, we will say your bug out bag altogether costs you about $20.
That sounds fine.
All told. And everywhere you go in town, everyone's like, oh, preacher, So glad you're here with us. I can't wait to hear your sermon come Sunday. Oh, hi, preacher. I heard he done some amazing things. I heard he calls down miracles from the Lord. That lady's weird. Nobody talks to her.
I'm only a man. All of you can do what I have done if you have the faith in your heart.
But it's clear to you, you are not only a man to these people. You are a celebrity, if not more.
Oh, I know, but you don't say that.
Of course, yeah, you've got to be humble.
Come on.
Humble brag. All right, cool.
Well,
I buy a new Bible.
A new Bible?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Because he's got a whole Bible.
I still keep my whole Bible.
But you can't read from a whole Bible.
Because I need to look up passages.
Yeah, I got to
I don't have the shit memorized.
How does one sermon taking notes? Bible will set you back another five.
That's fair.
That's an expensive book.
It's a nice Bible. It's a good book, I bet.
Gold leaf.
Before I leave the Harris Mining, I just want to see if they have like a business card or pen something. I don't know what they have. Or something.
At this point, they got word of mouth was pretty much their only.
Right. What sort of things though? Like a pen that maybe people.
Oh,
use?
I see. What are you trying? What do you be more specific?
I want to take a token of something that either Viola or potentially Carlton Harris could have used.
I would say it's super easy for you to grab a pencil that Viola is using for her
desk. I would just
desk.
Take a pencil.
I won't even make you roll for that. Viola is not the sharpest tool in the shed, and she is just totally smitten with your appearance.
Okay, and then after that, I would probably just look a little bit at the manor, but I want to go and... How far out this burlesque show from town? I mean, would it be something that I could
walk
towards?
It just said outside town.
It didn't say anywhere specific?
So, make a notice roll for me.
Okay. I really want to notice this.
Oh, okay. Wow, you really want to notice that. Yeah, I got quite a pile building back here behind my screen.
Five,
okay. So you can see off in the distance past the church, way, way off, almost specks from where you are at this point, there seems to be some sort of like little wagony type thing and the activity of like a few people walking around it.
I want to head that way. Still kind of eyeing the town as I do, but.
Okay, so you're also taking in the lay of the land, but you're looking for different things than Bogue, but you guys are finding what it is you need to know.
Mm-hmm.
These guys are like, oh, well, if you're
this
looking to be safe.
This is ruining my fun. I'm done with this.
Well, if you're, but the new preacher.
Oh, I didn't say that. I just, like, I just say, you know what? I feel like eating a baby.
What?
Yep, that's it. I'm worshiping Satan.
Did she say eat a baby, worship Satan? Is that? That's not right. And you leave them on. You're going to investigate the alleyway where the body pile was last night.
Also, by the way, did I have breakfast?
Man, I don't know. We skipped past that because it was a trivial detail, but...
Johnny had breakfast.
Johnny had pine cone.
I had a tobacco.
Is there a street vendor I can grab something? Because I want to be eating something when I'm looking at gross. Right?
There is a hot dog cart. No, there are no street vendors. You can get a meal at the hotel if you want. Mm. And there is at the general store. I'm sure you could buy a couple of foods.
I think I have. Nope. I'm gonna go back to the general store.
Okay.
Find the same clerk.
Okay.
And be like, I'm interested in something that I can stand and eat, maybe a jerky or an ice cream cone.
Oh, well, we don't have ice cream, but I could do like a penny pop for you, a lollipop, or I can show you the variety
of
them that we have.
What is the dimensions on that lollipop?
Well, sure, let's go take a look at the case. And he leads you over. This is probably
I start down that road, and then I go like, Tortno!
Okay, just a penny.
I buy a penny pop.
Do you have a penny, Tortla?
No.
Because I believe you have a collection of furs and beads
you
want
a bead?
To barter.
Can I give you a bead for that?
Oh, sorry, we don't accept beads.
This has been a waste of time. Leave again.
Okay.
Yeah, but I go to my meat pile.
Okay, well, it's not there.
I just wanted to eat something while I looked at it. That's all.
It's not there. It's gone.
It's not there!
Yeah, the meat pile's gone. No shoes, no hat, no meat pile. No service.
Are there still any tracks or anything?
Yeah, there's a lot of tracks. It looks like there was some recent activity here.
Like people came and took the meat pile away?
Looks like you definitely see some tracks that look like someone's hands might make if they were scooping up a meat pile on the ground. It's pretty, this was recent.
Yeah, yeah.
Pretty easy to read.
Well, the tracks that I saw before went a certain direction.
Those
I'm
are obscured
go that
at this point. There's what? Been those are obscured at this point.
Right, but I should remember where I saw them.
They
head
went
off
into the woods.
Okay. But can at I this see point, anything in there? Like it's they're gone.
The tracks?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's been all this activity around this meat pile, and it's really hard to follow them at this point. But you saw that they disappeared off into the darkness the time last night. I guess it was just last night.
Yeah, yeah.
At this point, the day is advancing due to GM Fiat. Did everybody get a chance to do their second thing?
Yeah.
No.
I don't think you did.
my second thing is I'm going into the Laughing Lady.
Okay.
I'm going to have me some whiskey. That's breakfast.
Okay.
Mm. Yeah.
So at this point, it's like 3 p.m.
Mm-hmm. So it's lunch.
Yeah.
But what? I'll just saddle up to the bar and just
brunch. We're in LA.
Whiskey.
Right.
Wait for that.
Counts. All right. And Nellie behind the bar, who you guys had met the night before, very, very stocky and
brunch
stern woman.
You wake up.
One whiskey.
And then as I do this, I'm just looking, at everyone who's in here, just sort of mental notes of faces and things like that. Just
as your eyes pass over all of them, they all break eye contact with you. You can tell they're all looking at you when you're not looking at them.
Right.
You're somewhat of a scary figure in town at this point on account of, all the shooting.
If you look back and forth across the bar, you can make everybody do the wave.
Yeah, kind of like the old school wave. All right.
Oh boy, hold on.
So hold on, guys.
Hold on.
What?
Our computer's shutting down.
Oh no! Uh-oh. Our computer's shutting down.
Oh no!
Uh-oh.
Why'd that happen?
Dom.
To the computers, Dom.
Oh, guys.
Dom, no. Are we still live?
To the Dom case.
Oh, yeah, we're still good?
Well, OBS is on.
All right.
Okay, small favors. Guys, hang with us for one moment while we deal with some technical difficulties. Once we get the go-ahead that anything we're doing can be viewed or seen,
right?
We will continue.
I should have done, it's hard to describe on the thing, but I should have done the doubling fives scam.
That is very hard to describe. That's a hard scam to describe.
But that's because, when you watch it, if you don't know what you're looking for, it's very hard to keep the numbers in your head. Mm.
You guys may not have heard this, but Jordan's a big fan of the movie Paper Moon, which I believe you can find now on HBO Go.
Well,
if you
can,
have that.
Or at least you could last week when I checked.
Yeah,
and
he's referring to a scene and a con that one of the characters uses in that. What's it called again?
It's called Doubling Fives.
Doubling Fives. It's very confusing to watch and to be a victim of, I'm sure.
So yeah. The way it works is you pay for something with a $5 bill that costs less than a dollar. You get $4 and change back, and then you just go, you know what? I've got an extra dollar. How about I just give you that, and then you give me a $5? And then you keep chatting with them while it's happening, and they hand you the $5, and you go, and make them kind of forget exactly what was going on. And you go, you know, just to make things simple, how about I'll just give you this $5, and you just give me a $10, and then, this breaks easier. And you put it in your pocket, and you go, thank you very much. Everyone walks out, and you just walked out with $10 instead of paying anything for the $1.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's still
confusing. Can't follow that.
Right?
I know, still
and that's exactly how it works, because every tiny step of the logic makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, when they pull out the $5, that's their $5.
Right.
And the ones are already their ones.
Right.
So then you give them their $5 and their ones back, and they give you one of their tens back.
Okay.
So you just use all of their money.
When you phrase it like that, it makes sense, kind of. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you took it. It costs a $5 to do.
Okay.
And you walk out with $10.
Okay.
That's why it's called doubling fives.
Okay. All right. Wait. Oh, is it?
Hello there.
The screen's back.
Yeah.
And
we're okay.
Everything's
we're okay.
Cool.
Yeah.
Everything's cool, guys. We're cool.
Did we get this follow? Did I?
We asleep? Did get that follow. Okay. That was a little while back. That was KBT Ellard. 1973, the jazz.
I feel like I may have misjudged when I said I don't need any money.
Your money's good in the Coyote Confederation.
Well, I've got a lot of beads, you guys.
You do. If you had to assign a monetary value to the beads and furs that you have, Tortla, what would that monetary value be?
The total monetary value would be $183.75.
It's going to be really hard to unload that until you find a currency exchange booth.
I thought you said you had a lot of bees. And I just imagine, like, Short keeps a bunch of bees. Tiny little
bag full of bees.
Pouch.
That's a separate thing.
So thank you guys for bearing with us through a brief bout of technical difficulties that may not have even been visible to you, but we assure you were climactic.
We were screaming the whole time.
Yes.
All right.
Yes. Yes. Nice. Live
so
the whole time.
You got our Dublin Fives.
Now you guys know about Dublin Fives. I still don't quite understand it, but you guys can teach me about it on Twitter. So, you guys ate, did everybody eat in town? At some, you found your own food.
Probably.
Or, tried real hard to, yeah. But no one would take my beads.
That's true, You're probably gonna have to rely on your trail
I find
trail
James,
pack.
And I'm like, I'm hungry and no one will take my beads.
Can we get some food for?
You pay for it with cursed Spanish gold?
Yep.
Such a bad
they
thing.
They don't know.
This money feels some. Cursed.
I order steak and lobster.
Like, anybody here smell a curse?
They don't have steak and lobster, Tortla.
Spanish money?
That doesn't stop me from ordering it.
Okay. They kind of go, okay, we got soup?
Soup? Okay. All right. First of all, I'm going to act outraged in character, but I am also outraged that soup? Soup is all they've got?
It's lunch. It's the cheapest meal of the day.
No, like beans? Eggs?
That's a breakfast.
Sandwiches?
You're talking breakfast food.
They probably just took most of the breakfast and threw it in a big pot with, like, broth.
I will eat your soup, sir.
That's 25 cents a person. For breakfast soup. I mean, just regular soup.
We'll have one soup.
All right. So you guys all pay for your meal at some point.
This is a wholly inadequate lunch.
And the day wanes on. You guys are able to find out all the things. You get a lay of the land. You meet some of the people. You get some ideas about town. You find out all the specifications of a late model butter churner.
Wonderful.
But now the sun is going down. And are you guys interested in going to the burlesque show? Or do you want to blow it off and plan some Holbrook stuff?
I think I'm interested in seeing what the burlesque show
I would definitely be interested.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because my instincts are that this could be like a competing con.
Yeah.
Okay.
Some sort.
So you see now from the church that out a little past the outskirts of town, you can see some sort of strange steam contraption. It seems large and bulky, and there are torches stuck in the ground on either side of it that are now aflame, and there are people starting to head over that way from town. From this vantage point, you can tell the audience seems to skew male, but there are a few ladies in attendance as well, perhaps just desperate for some entertainment of any kind. So you guys want to head over?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Dom, the player, would love to go over there. But I don't know if Bogue necessarily would. I think I'm going to keep my distance a little bit.
Okay.
I'm sort of going to be on the outskirts of it.
So you're going to hang back, making it clear that morally...
It's not moral necessarily.
Not moral.
No.
That you don't like fun or entertainment.
Right.
Okay, cool.
Well, I mean, honestly, I'm still worried that Holbrook is coming. I don't want to be caught off guard necessarily.
Sure.
So I'm just going to be... a little bit wary of...
What a cautious thing to do.
Yeah, right?
Mm. Nice. All right, so you guys
I like
head over.
You took the cautious hindrance and I took the overconfident hindrance.
Mm. Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It's like working together, yeah. We can do anything.
As long as we talk about it first and don't talk about it.
Right? Done.
So you head over. And there is a crowd forming now as the sun is going down and the moon is coming out. And there are five small children sitting on top of the steam wagon. Not on top of it, actually, part of it has broken down, and you guys were probably here in time to watch it just kind of and then part of the steam wagon front lowers down. This contraption, I don't know how familiar you guys are with new science, but this seems really unnecessarily kitted out. Like, it seems bulky and weird. There's panels and things that look like they slide out or slide in or rotate that you can't really see the purpose of. But it has lowered itself down and formed sort of like a makeshift stage that these children are sitting on. It's the same weirdly dressed children that were in town hanging up flyers earlier, and they just seem to be sitting there and watching the crowd come in. And after you guys stand there for a while, and the flow of people starts to slow down somewhat, as the night deepens a bit, the oldest girl stands up, and she pulls something out of her pocket and says, "Ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for assembling tonight to watch the marvelous Miss Sally Trenton and her marvelous arc. We promise this is a show you will never forget. She's the jewel of the West, finest burlesque in town. And also, there's a contest tonight where you could win a date this very evening with the marvelous Miss Sally Trenton herself. So, in fact, we'll all be just circling through the crowd, and for the price of just 25 cents, you can put your name on a slip into this hat and win a date with Miss Sally Trenton. So here we go. And the rest of the kids kind of go out and start circling through the town with a hat and slips of paper for people to write their name on, and they're taking quarters from people. She looked quite fetching on the sign, so many of the men in town are ponying up their quarter.
$2 worth of slips in there.
Mm. All right, so a little boy comes over to you. $2?
Yes, $2.
Okay, all right, so I think you get 8 slips.
That's 10.
What?
That's 10, son.
10. I'm sorry, 10 slips, so just write your names on it there.
Thank you.
Okay. And put them here in the hat.
He's like, the preacher doesn't know how to add. I'm not going to correct him.
All right, so they circle and they get the money and they come back up. And the oldest girl goes, all right, good luck to all of you. And now, without further ado, we present the marvelous Miss Sally Trenton. And she kind of, they all get off the stage and the torches go out. And the children you can see in the darkness kind of go over to the side of the stage and pick up a bunch of various and sundry instruments and start sort of awkwardly playing a kind of sultry-esque, weird sort of dissonant song. And then the torches relight, and appearing up on stage
is a
woman who is quite dolled up with excessive amounts of makeup. She looks to be... In her late 30s, and she's not unattractive, but she seems very uncomfortable on stage. And as the music starts playing, she starts just doing kind of like a
What sort of calm you think this is?
She's wearing kind of like a threadbare old dress and just entirely too much makeup. And she's just sort of looking out over the gathered crowd and just sort of like doing her best, like... burlesque dance. Can all of you make a notice roll for me? You make your notice roll. You're a bit out, right?
Yeah.
Make it at a -2.
Okay.
5.
And then she goes back and kicks a panel on the arc, and a drawer opens up, and she pulls out 2 like big feathers.
Ooh.
I got a 7.
7. The crowd's really quiet, and you hear one guy near you go, what is this? So you got a 7, you got...
I got a 5.
A 5?
2.
A 2? Okay, so, Tortla, you're enthralled by this. This is one of...
Wow.
This is the height of entertainment for you.
Oh my gosh, do you see what she's doing?
She's got the feathers now, and she's just sort of like going like that.
Tortla, if I win this date...
What?
I'll give it to you.
What?
If I win this date, I'll give it to you.
And she kicks
a
panel on the arc behind her, and just some sparks just kind of go, boom! You guys got a 5 and a 7?
Uh-huh.
And what did you get, James?
I got a critical fail.
James, you're not even looking at this.
Nope.
You're like, that music sounds awful. I'm not even going to look at that. You're just kind of looking out, just waiting for Holbrook's gang to appear
come.
Out in the darkness.
Please come.
You guys notice that... The marvelous Miss Sally Trenton seems to be scanning the crowd with a very intense focus. So as she's doing this, and not so much focusing on it, what it is that she's doing, she seems to be looking around at the crowd. Everyone make another notice roll for me. Thanks for the host, Happy Jacks RPG Live. You're here just in time for the burlesque show.
This is what everyone's really here for.
Right?
Right.
This is at a -1, by the way.
Oh, really?
I'm going to Spanish gold that shit.
Your Spanish gold?
Yeah.
She's taking her gloves off, and then she takes them off very slowly, and then turns around and puts them back on.
All right, I'll stick with my 5, actually.
You got a 5?
I got a 2 with a -1.
Ooh. Or just got a 4 with a minus 1.
Okay.
Oh.
Wow.
Okay, so that's a 13.
Ace the crap out of that. A 13? That's yeah. Minus 1?
Minus 1 makes it a 12.
Oh nice. My gun.
5.
Okay, so you got a 2 minus two. With a minus 3. Okay.
You can have my gun, Jim.
So at this point, you're just thinking very critically about this whole situation in your head. You're like, this is not good. She doesn't know what she's doing.
Mm-mm. I could teach her a thing too.
But you two notice that she seems to have zeroed in on one particular guy in the crowd. Just very briefly, there's a spark of recognition in her eyes. And you see her kind of turn to the band as a way to like be like, more music. But she kind of like indicates something to the oldest child, who perks up, and then she looks back at that man in the audience, and you see the oldest child kind of look over at that man in the audience, and the oldest child nods at her as she's dancing.
So only he sees this?
These two see it. You missed her scanning the crowd, but you see this for some reason.
I'm looking so hard at her.
She's casing us for something.
Oh. I'm looking so hard at her that I catch everything she does.
I'm going to make my way to him.
You hear another guy in the crowd go like, is she going to take anything off? She hits another switch and there's just more like sparks that go out.
I want to make my way towards the guy that she seems to be focused on.
Okay, so you're just sort of walking over there? Okay. And then she goes, ba-dum-ba-dum-ba.
Huh.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I am the marvelous Miss Sally Trout. Thank you. Her bad wig is just bobbing as she moves.
It is.
Yeah, I know. As illustrated. Thank you all for coming out and for watching the show. Now it's time for the drawing. Saucy, bring up that drawing bag here.
Oh my gosh.
The oldest girl comes up. All right, now the rest of you, can we get a nice dramatic drum roll, please? And they don't have any drums, so they just start to like bash on their instruments.
Have I made it to the guy?
Yeah, you're over by him.
Okay.
And she says, okay, Saucy, reach into that bag and pull out the lucky fella's name. And Saucy does. What is it, Saucy? And Saucy reads out, Mr. Craig Galway. Do we have a Mr. Craig Galway out here? And the guy right next to you goes, yeah, I'm Craig Galway.
Takes off his wig.
He takes off his wig. Then he puts it back on. It's very confusing. This is her now. Suspension of disbelief. Oh, Mr. Galway, you sure are a lucky fella. You and I are going on a date right now. In fact, I've got a room reserved over at the hotel for us to have a private dinner and party.
Now, ma'am, Mr. Galway is part of my flock, and I can't let him go get into a situation where sin could be involved. Isn't that right, Mr. Galway?
Preacher, don't speak for me, all right? I done want a date with this lady, and, you know,
sir,
she ain't sir. Exactly much to look at, I know, but it's been a while.
Sir, she had you pegged out of the audience. There's a reason she is picking you out.
And she is kind of watching this exchange and going, no, preacher. Wait, I've been hearing about you. You're that preacher that calls down miracles. The new preacher for this town of, what's the name of it? Canyony?
It's Coldwater.
That's the one.
I'm proud of it.
Wow, that's great. Ladies and gentlemen, the preacher's here. Let's all clap for the preacher. The preacher came here to watch this burlesque show, I guess. The preacher has some racy tastes. And preacher, I hope you didn't fall in love, because I don't believe you. Are you allowed to get married? I don't know how that works.
I'm married to the Lord.
Oh, of course. Well, preacher, Mr. Galway and I were about to go off on our date. So, kids, why don't you give the preacher our biggest, songiest welcome? Everybody, kids, go over there, gather around the preacher, give him a songy welcome, and play us off to the hotel. All right. And the kids all kind of get around you and just start, like, playing banjos and, like, a trombone at you. And she comes down and takes Mr. Galway by the arm, and the rest of the crowd are like, woo, and they start walking towards the town.
I want to follow them.
You want to follow them?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the kids kind of just, like, stay with you.
What's her name again?
Which one?
Her name.
Sally?
Yes, Sally.
Oh, you're still dealing with her. Okay, Sally. Great. Good.
I want to run up behind her and go, Sally, can I speak with you for a moment?
Oh, hold on. Miss, there'll be time for autographs later on, but I do have a date to go on right now.
Oh, I know you do, but I don't know if I'll run into you again. I just wondered, how did you do all of that stuff? It was so fascinating.
Oh, that was my Ark. Yeah, it was specially customly built. Now, that's Ark with a Q. The man who built it was very insistent on that. But it's a marvel of modern technology. That's the way he tells it. We travel around in that. It's our entertainment vehicle.
Well, that's quite amazing.
Yeah, and I can talk to you all about it tomorrow. We'll be here for a few days.
Oh, but I'm not going to be here tomorrow, so I'd love to talk to you right now. I'd love to know how you plan on taking money from this man here.
So that's a lie, right?
Yeah.
Okay, but that's not important because you said that after that.
I did.
It was a little less.
and they both kind of stop for a second, and he just kind of looks at her confused. And she goes, you mean his for his raffle tickets?
No, it just seemed to me, from what I understood, from what the preacher was saying, that he actually picked him out from the crowd. Well, it wasn't because you drew his...
Yeah, no, Saucy drew his name. It was a fair drawing.
No, but I think you planted it, right? I'm just fascinated.
Well, hold on. And Craig Galway's like, what? What's going on?
Oh, I'm sorry, Craig. You didn't see that.
And she goes, well, now, hold on. Now, Craig, have we ever met before? And he goes, no, I'm pretty sure I'd remember you. Right. So how could I have planted Mr. Galway's name? You saw everybody walked around and filled out their sheet and put them in the hat, and Saucy drew one, and this is the name that came up. I'd have gone on a date with any one of these remarkably handsome fellows here in Coldwater Creek. And you hear a bunch of people around just go like, yeah.
Well, I did happen to see...
I'm seeing someone.
Actually, not interested.
I did happen to see some of your children running around town earlier.
Whoa. Bandana Man, thank you for the donation.
Thank you, Bandana Man.
Well, yes, they were hanging up flyers so people would know about the show. Now, I really must insist, I apologize, miss, but we can catch up later on. I do have a date to get
Craig,
to right now.
Craig is his name?
Craig.
Craig. Craig, I'd tell you to protect your wallet. I wouldn't trust this one. I've seen the likes of her before. This is when I started hanging with the preacher. I turned from my old ways. I'm just saying, you should watch out for
well,
this one.
Well, miss, that is downright rude of you, and if I wasn't such a consummate professional, I would be offended. But I know when to recognize professional jealousy in its place, and I'm telling you, honey, you've got the looks for it. You know, I could teach you a thing or two about this business,
ma'am,
and we can talk about it later on, okay? Now, I don't want to stay here and let you stew in it more. It's hard to bask in this, I understand. But I've got to get this gentleman to the hotel for our date.
Of
dinner will be getting cold, Craig.
Oh, you're right. Are you paying for that dinner?
Guys, raise a glass.
I will.
This is a toast from Bandana Man 95.
Bandana Man.
Raise a glass to Craig and his future financial downfall.
To Craig and his future financial downfall.
Set him up. Knock him down. All right, so she just kind of like pushes you off, and Craig just sort of looks at you and just seems confused and keeps going with her, and they kind of get
have
sort
a good
of
night,
escorted
Craig.
By the
gun.
Yeah, thanks. And they disappear into the front door of the hotel. So there's a lot of hustle and bustle going on as people are leaving the show. A lot of them are going, is that it? That's it? That was...
Can I
think it was 5 minutes long.
Can I go back over to the wagon and see if there's anything I can take?
Sure. But first, everyone make a notice roll for me.
Okay.
So did you all come into town? Did you all follow like the crowd of people like heading back?
If I saw them start to leave, I would have seen that and followed them.
Five.
Okay.
10. Mm.
10.
10.
Five.
All right, so everybody succeeded, and you guys succeeded with the raise. So you two hear a little bit of a commotion coming back from like the front doorway of looks like the news office as the crowd is coming into town, and you turn and look, and at this point you guys start to hear it too, and there seems to be a man and woman up there in a little bit of a confrontation, and their voices are getting heated, and she just kind of pulls a knife from off of his belt. And starts just slashing at his chest. And he's backing off. Like, she just gets, like, a couple cuts on him, but nothing deep.
And he seems confused and agitated, and he's backing off, and she's kind of just like standing there.
Wait, who are these people?
Just random townsfolk. This is just happening off like on the outskirts of the crowd, but you all notice it. And she's standing on the porch, like kind of shaking almost. You can't tell, but she's definitely experiencing some very strong emotion. And he's kind of like backing up. He seems very confused, and he's like trying to see how much he's bleeding. That's what you see, but then the crowd of people continues to move forward. Are you guys?
I would probably head towards that just to see what was going on.
Okay.
At least.
So you guys start heading closer, and you hear him saying, "What are you doing? What in the hell are you doing?" And she was like, "You shouldn't have said those things. You shouldn't have said. Why would you say that?" He's like, "I didn't say nothing. You just started attacking me with a knife."
Well, what's going on here?
She's gone crazy. My wife's lost her full head. He was saying such evil things. I wasn't saying it. We were walking. We were out walking. She just attacked me.
Ma'am, can I have the knife, please?
She kind of looks at you and she seems a bit confused, and she hands the knife over to you. I didn't mean to.
Why don't you talk
vile things.
Why don't you talk to my friend Rosie over here, while I talk to your husband?
Are you all right? What did he say?
Yeah, I'd rather not. I don't know.
Well, it's all right. Do you need some water? Do you want to go?
I think just sit down for a second might be
all
nice.
All right, there's the bench right over
and
here.
And you're talking to the husband?
Yeah.
He's just like, I don't know what happened. We were just walking. We were having a nice time. And all of a sudden, she turns on me and starts telling me to shut up what I'm saying and starts slashing at me with the knife. Never seen her like that before. And I don't know rightly what's happening right now. Tor, did you come over here as well? Or? I mean, you saw it happen, but you also saw them walk over.
Yeah. Don't think I did, no.
Okay, where are you, what are you occupied by?
Who are you, what?
So you saw this woman, the marvelous Miss Sally Trenton, disappear into the hotel with Craig. Go away.
Mm-hmm.
And the crowd just kind of seems to be dispersing and like heading over to the saloon, since they find themselves with suddenly a lot of time on their hands because they thought they were gonna see a show.
I really like this show.
It was pretty good.
I really like this show.
I mean, it's not for everybody, there was a lot to appreciate there for you.
Yeah.
There was a lot to unpack.
Look, they didn't they didn't have the palate for how great this show was.
This is the Tim and Eric of the Wild West.
So,
before its time.
So I'm going to kind of hang out around the hotel.
Okay.
Maybe find see if I can't spot, like, they went upstairs. Walk around the outside looking at the windows.
Yeah, you can.
Maybe I'll turn into an owl again.
Okay.
But only if I know which window to go to.
Sure. Well, I mean, there's a lot of windows that are lit up there, but it looks like it would actually be relatively easy to climb one of these drain pipes on the side of the hotel and get up onto the little, like, roof overhang by these windows.
Then I'll totally do that.
Like
or,
an owl.
Yeah, you could climb it like an owl. So make your climb roll.
I will. I'll climb the crap out of this.
Gabriel, what are you doing? Are you over here consoling this woman with them?
Christian! Thank you.
Thank you for the donation, Christian. Well, hold on. Sorry. What was your climb roll?
Nine.
All right. You climb the crap out of that. So climb it just like an owl and up onto the ledge. So you're going to need to make a stealth roll to look in any of these windows without being seen. But real quick, what are you doing?
I think when I see you guys going over to handle that, I'm gonna basically be like, Rose, if you need any help, do not hesitate to call, but I am gonna see what is going on with this woman.
All right.
Okay. So I'm gonna head with Tort and kind of scope out.
So you see her climbing up the side of this drain pipe, sort of down in the darkness of the side of the building.
Yep.
And you know kind of, at least generally, what she's up to, so you head over that way.
Yeah.
Before we get to that stealth roll, the woman has started to calm down now, and so has her husband. I'm sorry, I don't know what happened. I lost a child. We were trying to conceive, and I miscarried. And he was just saying the worst. He was saying it was my fault. He was saying that he should leave me. He was saying he should have killed me.
What? He said all of that to you?
But he wouldn't say those things. That's what was... And I just got so angry that I lost control, and I don't know what happened, and I feel terrible.
Well, Were you just out walking? What happened before that?
We were walking, and all of a sudden, he just started saying the most hateful, vile things. And I couldn't.
That's not like him, you're saying.
It's not. No, he's a very loving, kind-hearted man.
Well, this seems quite strange. He seemed to be saying he didn't say anything.
It is a little strange. It's even highly strange. As though the chat maybe unlocked a little high strangeness in town this evening. Thank you very much, chat.
Where were you when she lashed out at you?
We're just walking up here. We were trying to get out of the way of the crowd. Just walked up onto the porch of the newspaper office right here, and she just turned on me like a feral woman.
Well, listen, here's your knife back. I think it's just hot-headedness that just took over. Maybe some swamp gas or something.
I ain't never seen it from her before.
Yeah, well, I think just take it easy. Just maybe buy a nice dinner for her, and cooler heads will prevail.
I the hotel, they only serve soup.
I want.
Well, that was for lunch.
To
they have hot soup for dinner.
Bring her back over. And to him, if she wants to go,
she does, but she seems very she won't meet his eyes.
It's all right. So it seems that talking to him that you all have had a bit of a hard time lately, and I think maybe just from what your wife was saying.
What was she saying?
Well, that you lost a child or a potential child.
Did, but why, honey? Why would you tell her?
But it's all right. I won't tell anyone that. That's a hard thing to go through.
It is, and that's I'd rather not discuss it, but why did that come up?
Well, I just think that maybe you both are dealing with some things, and it just kind of came out in a weird way, and she obviously feels quite bad about it.
Well, yeah, I guess we do have a couple things to talk about. Thank you, folks, for your kindness. And they sort of, like, they nod to you and offer their good nights, but they walk away with some very clear space between them. Meanwhile, back at the hotel, you're making a stealth roll to peer in a window.
Yes. Well, I mean, I made it.
Okay, you did. That's pretty good because no one is expecting second floor window looker-inners at this point.
That's the technical term.
That's the technical term.
No one is expecting second floor window looker-inners.
You guys remember that. It's a classic. By the way, Christian Linke would like to donate a pack of rerolls to Gabriel Pryor.
Ooh.
Yeah.
And he says, here's to my favorite streaming channel.
Thank you, Christian. Thanks, Christian.
Thank you.
We appreciate that. So you look in the window, and there just seems to be, like, an old businessman in here, and he's kind of stripped down to his skivvies, and he's doing some exercises.
Like they do.
But I need to move on to another window.
Yeah, you should probably do that. Make another stealth roll.
A six.
Okay. So you look in this next window.
Another businessman, also in skivvies.
There's a whole conference of them. And you see Miss Sally Trenton, the marvelous Miss Sally Trenton, leading Craig Galway over to a finally appointed table where a candle is already lit.
Man, I'm so jealous.
And she gestures for him to sit.
Oh, that could have been me.
And he does. He seems to be smirking and just kind of pulls up and takes a seat there. And she offers to get his coat, from what you can tell.
So nice of her.
And she takes his coat and
she is a lady.
Hangs it up on the wall. And then she walks over to the table. And she says something, and he laughs, and she laughs, and it seems like they're having a great time.
She's probably being hilarious right now.
And she grabs...
Who Tort wants to be when Tort grows up.
She's so good, you guys. You haven't seen her, but she's so good. You you see her raise a glass on the table that appears to have some sort of wine
and I do
or
this
fine liquor in it.
With an imaginary glass outside.
And he raises his. She goes up to cheers, and then she seems to stumble, and she kind of like flings her glass onto his shirt.
Oh, is she gonna
and
be
he,
okay?
He puts his glass down and just kind of looks back, and she goes, "Oh," makes a big show of being upset, and kind of comes over with a towel and starts trying to pat down his shirt. Make a notice roll for me.
Five.
As she does that.
Yeah.
You see that with one hand she's patting down his chest and kind of occupying his attention, and with her other hand she reaches into a pocket of her dress and pours a tiny little bit of clear liquid into his glass and then repockets that and kind of like pats him down one final time and seems to proffer some sort of apology and goes and sits back down at the table and just again does something apologetic. Oh. She laughs, he laughs.
I laugh.
And he holds up a hand and offers to refill her glass, which she kindly accepts. He pours a little from the bottle into her glass, and she, once again, sort of abashedly, raises up her glass for a toast, and they clink their glasses together.
Yep.
And they go to take their drink. So, with what you've seen, are you going to do okay? All right. So, they raise it up, and she drinks deep, but she doesn't break eye contact with him the entire time.
He is so lucky.
He raises it up to his lips and stops for a moment and kind of sniffs just a tiny bit. And pulls his glass back and looks at it, and she's kind of frozen right there.
How rude of him to not drink their toast.
I really want them to hear that, but it's so much fun just to let it stand. They both just sort of freeze for a little bit and just regard each other. Mm-hmm. And then he throws his glass down to the ground, and she steps back, and he walks over and opens his coat and pulls out a revolver and just flips it over in his hand and clubs her across the face
with the
butt of it. And she crumples and drops to the ground. All right, how are you going to interfere?
What kind of window is this? Does it open?
It is a glass window, and it is just one solid pane of glass.
I'm going to attempt to
crash I'm sorry, it's shuttered. Yeah, you would be able to raise it up from the inside. From the outside, yeah.
I am going to dive head first into this glass window.
Okay.
I might bounce off it like a bird.
You might also suffer some glass shredding damage.
I might.
Okay.
All worth it.
But
he has attacked time is a of work the essence. Of art.
Yes. And as you are preparing your powerful hind legs to propel you through this glass window, you see him shout out something loud. It's loud, but you can't hear the words. It's muffled through the glass. Downstairs, kind of looking up at what's going on. Right. And what have you two done now that the other couple have walked away?
I mean, I would probably follow over.
So you're probably heading over to him going like, what are you doing here? Or something, some such like that. Mm-hmm. You hear a commotion from inside. And you guys would probably all have eyes on this through a window. A group of four men downstairs.
How are they getting to see through the window?
Downstairs window.
Okay.
Stand up suddenly from their tables and rush over for the stairs and start charging upstairs, and they're all reaching into their coats.
What? This is the hotel?
This is downstairs in the hotel.
Right.
This is like down in the dining area.
Where's Tortlaw?
Tortlaw is up.
And at that point, she is also about to try and explode through a window. So, Tortlaw.
Yes.
My Paul Stanley Starchild cosplay is terrible, Chet. Well, that's because I didn't have the full makeup on. If you guys saw it, it would be glorious, and you would be ashamed that you criticized it. Tortlaw, you're up there about to jump through this window. So, what do you think it would take to jump through a window? Is that a strength check?
I think it's
a...
Are there no shoes? Thank you for the follow.
Thank you.
I really wish it was agility. But it's probably strength.
I'm thinking it's probably strength, but if you could justify agility, I'll allow that.
Well, I am on a windowsill or
you're on
like a
roof
narrow
kind
area.
Of, yes.
So it's going to be like, I'm going back to the edge as far as I can maintain my balance. I'm like, if someone was watching me, they'd be like, whoa, but I'm not.
Okay.
So that I can get as much momentum as I can and the slats are not great on this balcony.
They're not great.
So maintaining my footing to create the momentum, that's my agility.
Okay.
Also, my dive is going to be glorious. Dive through the window.
Then 100% that's an agility roll, so make that roll.
Don't forget to use your powerful owl back legs.
Just like an owl would have.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Ooh.
They're there. Powerful owl legs.
11.
Mm-hmm. 11.
Yes.
That's a pretty good roll. That's a success with a raise, almost two raises. So you rear back on your powerful owl legs and do just the coolest leap through this window. and you actually, you fold yourself down into a small enough shape to burst through the bottom half of the window without hitting any of the sill of the window.
Oh, good.
And go crashing through it now.
And I'm somersault and pop up to my feet.
You are going to take some damage.
Of course I am.
But since this is cinematic, you're only going to take window-breaking action hero damage. So just a D4. 2 points of damage, that's not enough to get past your toughness, Tortlaw.
I'm super tough.
So you get a couple little nicks and scratches that are cosmetic only, and you crash through the window and roll into place.
You don't need to take anything off of the tracker.
And we are in combat.
Oh. Ooh.
Bam.
So Wait. You guys do not yet realize you are in combat.
Right.
It's just me and him.
It's just you and him in here at this point. Anything you want to say?
Oh, something.
Or do before, like you have one, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. How dare you disrespect this glorious creature! Also?
Yeah.
I'm gonna, on the inside, transform into a gorilla. I don't know what gorillas are.
You probably don't, yeah. You've never seen a gorilla. That's not a real thing. into a bear?
Yep, only on the inside.
On the inside.
Because I don't have time for a full transformation.
Okay.
That makes sense.
That does make sense. That makes a lot of sense to me. There's no time for that here. All right, so, Tort, if you want, I will give you time to pull a weapon as part of your glorious movement through the... Oh, yeah, get that out
Sorry.
Of the way.
Sorry. Put it back.
Well, it's going to have to be my stone knife.
Your stone knife? Okay, so you're pulling your knife as you say this. Don't hurt this glorious creature.
Yes.
Yes, all right. So there's the table. There's a chair here, there's his chair.
Where is she?
She will be represented by this dual-wielding nun. And she will be on the ground right there.
Is this the window I came in through?
This is the door. This is the window you came in through, as indicated by glass shards.
Where am I?
So you roll right into there.
Yes!
And he is standing right here. All right, guys. We're in combat, or at least these two are. You two don't yet quite understand what has happened. You see Tortla do something owly upstairs, and you hear the sound of breaking glass. You also saw those men rush upstairs from downstairs in the hotel.
And they were reaching for weapons?
They were reaching into their coats.
Okay. I would say that would trigger me to, no pun intended, to think...
We're back!
Yay!
Thanks for your patience, guys. We were just figuring out while we lost you for a brief second whether or not Talene could use her blowgun in melee, which you can do. You can use a ranged weapon in melee, but instead of trying to hit a target number of 4, which is what you're trying to hit with a ranged attack, you'd be trying to hit their parry instead. So it's harder to hit someone in melee with a ranged weapon than it is to do it from further away.
Okay. It doesn't matter to my dice rolls, honestly. It matters... I think it matters to, like...
Into a fireball! Thank you for the follow.
Fighting style would be, like, Tortla's natural fighting style is going to be to reach for the blowgun first. The knife is actually just for skinning things.
Sure.
So I think I made a bad call there. I think I would have gone for the blowgun.
Okay, I'll say that you can bring out the blowgun if you want.
Okay.
Sure. All right, so you get a 7 of hearts. Rosaline, 8 of clubs. Mm-hmm. Gabriel Pryor, a 5 of hearts.
All right.
James Bogue, 2 of diamonds. Oof. And then Craig Golway gets a 3 of hearts.
Oh, thank God.
And Craig's crew gets a 6 of clubs. All right, for those of you who've never seen Savage Worlds before, this is the initiative system. Everybody gets a card, and then we count down from ace all the way down to 2, and we go in that order. Some people can have special abilities that they can use to manipulate the initiative system, but I don't think anyone at the table has that. So we'll start at the top. Who is our highest deal on the table?
I think
it's Rosaline.
Okay, interesting. So we're downstairs, right?
You guys are downstairs. Actually, all right. So you guys are downstairs outside.
I see.
At this point, so
where's
Gabriel's
the front door?
Right here. There's James. The front door is actually down in here. So here's the front door, and then you would have to run inside and then up there.
And are the guys down here already up the stairs?
They're on their way up the stairs.
So it's not like I could try and catch them?
You could try and catch them, but there's a bunch of other people down in the downstairs area of the hotel as well. Maybe we need some battle music. I think we might need some battle music.
Yeah.
Let's see. It's not a battle to death. But that's the only battle music I have, so it's battle to the death.
It's a battle to the death. It's a battle to the death.
Please here we stop go. Saying stop that. As the person most likely to die in this encounter, yes. Please stop
so
saying that.
All right, so they are clearing the top of the stairs at this point. So it's probably going to take you your whole round of movement to get to the front door and be able to see inside.
Just that, so I couldn't even get inside?
You can't get inside. You can get up to the front door, unless you want to pull a tort law and burst through a window.
I don't want to do that.
We can call that a tort law slash John McClane.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Barefoot. Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, I mean, I'm not going to be able to do anything anyway until I get in there. So I might as well. I mean, he told us that Tort was upstairs.
Yeah.
So I can at least gather that something's going on upstairs. And you used climb to get up there?
I don't
have climb. Okay. I'll just try
I'm
and
really
get through.
I'm glad I ended up with climb. I rejected it at first.
Right? You didn't want to have climb, but look, you wouldn't have been up here peeping through hotel windows without it. So what are you
all over the world?
What are you doing, Rosaline?
So I'm just going to try and get to the front door.
All right, so you're going to try and get to the front door? So you can do that. It'll take your movement phase to get to the front door.
Okay.
So are you going to try and do anything? Are you going to draw a weapon?
I was kind of thinking of taunting, but I honestly don't know, like trying to get their attention, but I don't really.
You could try and taunt one of them. There's four of them getting up to the top. You've got a voice that can carry pretty well.
Yeah, I do, but I don't entirely know what I want to taunt them with right now.
So you know how taunting works, though, right? So if you successfully taunt one of these guys, you're going to get a +2 to your next action against them.
Right.
Reverend Pryor, can you reach into that cooler there and acquire a beverage of some kind, slake my mighty thirst?
There are many options of beverages.
Whiskey?
Would you like a Coke or a Dr. Pepper or one of our many beers or a Diet Coke Zero?
Dr.
Or
Pepper sounds fantastic. However, do you or do you not have a root beer's within that cooler?
I don't want to interrupt this too much, but what did you want to do in combat?
Well, one of A&W's classics.
Wow, A&W makes an excellent root beer.
Now you sound like Miss Daisy. Yeah. They make an excellent root beer.
What do you got, Rosaline? Or else I'm going to pass you.
I know. I just don't know what to do here. I'm confused as to what she would know.
You don't, and I think that's right. You are confused as to what's going on at this point.
I just want to.
Can you hold your action?
Yeah, maybe that would be better. I mean, but if I hold my action, I can't move.
You can't move and hold your action, yeah.
I think then I'll just come to the door and just yell very loudly, "What's going on here?"
That's your taunt.
Okay.
It's not a taunt because that's not going to taunt anybody.
Okay.
I'm just trying to distract people.
A lot of the people in the eating at the hotel are like, "We don't know." but the guys going up the stairs are singular of purpose. They are not distracted by that. Can I have your card?
Yeah.
All right. Next up, I believe it's Tortlaw.
Okay.
Who the hell are you?
I am your worst nightmare, you attacker of beauty.
What? So you pull your blowgun.
Yeah.
Okay, and you try and shoot him. So you are far enough away that you could pull it up and shoot him.
Can I? Do I have an attack move combo here?
Yeah.
So I can move and then attack?
Mm-hmm. Or you could attack and then move.
I can attack and then move?
Okay. Or you could do a thing, move, then do another thing.
All right, okay. I need to attack and then move.
Okay.
Blowgun!
So you're going... So let me just check real quick. Your only action this turn is going to be to attack him and then move.
Yeah, what I'm going to do is I'm going to blowgun him, but what I want to do after that is I want to run and dive under the table and knock it up so that I've got a barrier.
Okay, doing that would be another action.
Okay.
So that would give
can
a minus 2 to
your blowgun.
Can I
dive under the table, though? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you can dive
I'll
under
take
the table.
That.
You can dive under the
I'll
table.
I'll take that.
Okay, so make your blowgun roll.
Ah!
You had a dart locked and loaded in your blowgun.
I totally did.
Hey,
Alice, Alice and James, 10-10. Thanks for the follow.
Thank
you. 1-0.
5?
It's range, so, right? Is
mm-hmm. this a range? Yeah, you're trying to get a 4 at this point. There's nothing in between, you guys. All right. So, you hit. Roll damage. Blowgun, I believe, was 2d4 plus 1, I think is what we said.
Yeah, I wrote it down somewhere. 2d4.
There is not really a blowgun in the Savage Worlds rules. We kind of homebrewed this for Tulene. Ooh, that's a double ace.
8.
Hey.
Nice.
And 4 more. So 7. I will live with 7.
7?
This is yours, right?
Well, it's 2d4 plus 1. She aced both of those.
Oh, yeah. You aced both of them.
Yeah.
Did you roll both of them?
Add everything together.
Oh. 8 plus...
You got a 1 and a 3.
One and a 3, so it's 12.
A 1 and a 3, that's a 12. Okay.
Plus 1 is 13.
Plus, that's a 13. That is a hit.
Wow.
And 2 raises on this guy. But Chad has unlocked a deadly promotion.
Whoa.
Which means that in the next fight that you guys got into, that's this fight, one of the characters would be upgraded from an extra into a wild card.
Whoa.
That means Craig Galway is gonna be a little bit of a tougher customer for you guys. And it also means, hold on, not looking.
Crap.
That Craig gets 2 fate chips of his own to use. And he is going to spend one of them to make a soak roll against this move. So I'm gonna spend that there. And Craig is going to try and soak these wounds. So he, I said a hit and 2 raises, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that means he is trying to soak 2 wounds. All right, so Craig has a vigor of 6.
It's quite vigorous.
All right, he soaked one of them. I'll take it. Hand me those. So Craig reels back. He doesn't know quite what to make of you diving through the window like this.
Because I'm super awesome.
He says, what are you? And you say, how dare you attack this beautiful creature?
Also, he's never fought a bear before.
He hasn't. No, it's very off-putting. And you rear back and launch a dart at him, and it hits him right in the neck.
Mm-hmm.
And it just gets him like right in a nervous, like a nerve center, because you know where to aim for. And he seems to kind of seize up a bit. He is shaken.
But then
he is wounded.
But I am gonna
And then you run move and dive under the table.
Dive under the table.
Okay. All right, turn in your card. At this point, does anyone have a 6 or better?
I have a 5.
All right, so Craig's boys burst into the room.
Thank goodness I'm under a table.
Yeah, actually, that was really good because they don't have any idea what's going on. So they burst in.
Oh, it's another
nuns.
It's another, gun nun. Oh, look, and it's Action Jackson
nun
as well. How did these guys get into the Deadlands
the
miniatures? Awesome. Don't worry about it. Hand wave. And they go and they see him on the ground. They see the marvelous Miss Sally Trenton on the ground over there. They go, boss, what's going on? And he says, she's under the table. Get her. But that's all that they get to do this round. It takes a lot for them to get coordinated. That's their card. Who's next? Gabriel Pryor?
Mm-hmm. That's me.
That's you.
All right, so I'm gonna run up into the room, and I still don't really know
you're outside,
what's going on.
So you can run. It's gonna take you 2 rounds to.
I want to follow Rose.
Okay.
So how did Rosaline get up? Did she?
I just walked
she's,
into
she's
the,
just,
she's went out.
She's in the front door.
I'm
she's standing in the front door downstairs.
In that case, I'm going to. So she's downstairs. She's not.
She's down. You guys are all downstairs. She's not in the room.
I'm just at the front door of the base of the hotel.
Now, actually, I would say if you guys wanted to spend your turn doing a run, which is when you roll your running die, which is a d6, and add that to your pace for the round, there's a chance that you could make it all the way upstairs in one round, and I'd give you the opportunity to do that because I forgot to mention that as possible.
No, I knew that I could do that. I wasn't trying to go that far. I was just trying to... I didn't think I could do that and taunt them, which I didn't end up doing anyway.
Sure.
But it doesn't matter.
So yeah, you could roll your running die, and I'll say if you get a 6 on that, you can run all the way upstairs and be at the upstairs door in this round.
I feel like I should do that, but I feel like I'm not aware enough that there's something crazy going on.
That
so
makes total
I'm
sense.
Going to take my gun out and just take a normal move and kind of like head up the stairs following these guys.
Okay, so you draw your gun.
There's something going on, but I don't know that Torts burst in.
Sure. You draw your gun, but you can only make it to the front door with Rosaline this round. It's going to take you your other round to make it up the stairs to the room. And I'm going to give both of you the chance to draw for playing accurately the confusion of not knowing what's going on. So take a fate chip for not metagaming this.
Oh, red.
Well done, guys. All right, so you draw your gun. That's at least an action for
it,
and I'll take that from you. All right, all the people in the hotel lobby are like, that's the preacher, too! He's got his gun out! I believe it's, it's him. All right, well, he's got a roll to unshake.
Don't do it.
Oh, he might
do
it.
Don't do it.
He might do it. He's got a spirit
come on, guy.
Of D6
Don't be
as well.
A jerk.
Yeah, come on.
Guys.
Come on, guys.
Come on, guys.
Come on, guys. Come on, guys.
Wow.
Hey, oh, mother effer.
I'm not even gonna, that's an ace. I'm not gonna roll it again because he does unshake. So he rolls up. He already had one of his guns out. So he's just going to crouch down underneath the table uh-huh. and try and double tap his gun. He's got a double action revolver. He's gonna fire two rounds at you under the table.
Okay.
But you are going to get a, he's gonna be at a minus one because you're under the table and he's kind of like firing really quickly down there. So he gets to add a plus one to his attack and damage for doing a double tap, but he fires two bullets. So here he goes.
Fail.
So he got a five.
Yeah.
He got a five. So that is, what is, oh, it's at range. So now he's gonna do his damage. So can I have those back again?
Yeah, I can.
Hoo-yah. Oof. Eight, what's your toughness, Tort?
My toughness is five.
Five, okay, so that clears your toughness, but not with a raise, so you are shaken. So you can knock your miniature sideways there. I know I didn't hand out the shaken tokens tonight. That's my bad, oops,
I'm
GM.
I'm shaken.
So he hits one of the table legs right next to you, and a spray of wood flies up and just kind of like gets into your eyes.
I did not think this through.
And you're kind of like shaken back by that. So that's what happened there.
Other right. people have guns.
That's his turn. You're up, James Bogue. Now, if you say you're going to act with the confusion, that'll actually be metagaming because you'll know you're going to get a fate chip. So really, you're in a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation.
Well, like I said, I see guys pulling drawn weapons running up to where I know Tort is. I'm going to assume something's going on up there. Whether it's Tort involved or not, I'm trying to keep everything like we have enough problems with Holbrook and everything potentially coming in here. I want to try and keep things on the down low. So I'm going to.
Well, that's kind of out the window at this point.
Yeah. Well, not on the down low, but I want to try and keep things quiet. But
okay.
Anyway.
You hear gunfire from upstairs.
Yes. That's it. So I'll run upstairs.
Okay. So are you gonna try and roll your run die to go upstairs as well? Okay.
Yeah.
So move up to the front door. You can move his miniature there, and then roll your run die. If you roll a. We'll just say if you roll more than a three, we'll get you up there. I don't want you to waste your roll die. So if you roll more than a three on your run die, you can get up the stairs.
And I can use my wild die.
I believe so. I'll check on that later, but for the time being, we'll say yes.
Okay.
But it's one or
three.
Okay. Three?
Yeah. You said more than a three?
I did. Boom. Oh, don't put it in there.
Yeah, well.
Give it right here. That's where the cursed Spanish gold goes.
Thanks for thinking about the team.
You want it.
That'll do it. All right, so James Bogue, you go pushing past Rosaline and Gabriel and charge right up the stairs. Are you pulling your weapon as you go?
Yeah.
I'll allow that. And technically it's supposed to be a negative, but it's way cooler.
Well, I'm a quick draw, so.
Well, that's right, you are a quick draw. You draw a free action. There you go, it's in the rules, we did it. And you make your way.
I'm like, Bogue! Damn it.
Do you say anything as you run by?
Up
the stairs?
Nope.
Okay.
I don't.
And then you pull up right behind these guys. Do you say anything to them?
Hello, boys.
What? Yeah. All right, turn in your card.
All right.
One round of combat down. Second round. Let's do it. James
high
Bogue.
Card, high card, high card.
Seven
high
of diamonds. Card. Tort Law.
Four clubs.
Dang it.
Rosaline. Ten of diamonds.
Ooh, nice.
Gabriel Pryor. Queen of spades. Nice. Craig Galway.
Oh.
Ace of clubs.
Oh,
come on.
And Craig's boys. Queen of Diamonds.
Oh. Dadgummit!
All right, well, I go before the boy.
You do, because it's reverse alphabetical order by suit. In case of a tie, that's easy to remember. Here we go. Craig is going first. He says, you ain't getting away from me down here. I got you pinned. And he pulls another gun from out and is apparently going to two-fist these guns. So, he's going to get a penalty, a multi-action penalty for drawing a weapon and firing both. But because he is a two-fisted wild card, he doesn't get the multi-action penalty for his firing. So his first gunshot is going to be at a minus two. His second one's going to be at a minus four for being his offhand.
Bring it.
All right.
I feel good about this. I feel
here we go.
The bear within me is going to intimidate him into a misfire.
Yep.
That's pretty good. He's going to spend a piece of cursed Spanish gold to redo that roll.
And he can try that all he wants, but it's in his head now.
It is in his head.
But he's gonna rally and spend another piece of cursed Spanish gold because I've got a trove back here.
Yeah. You may have a trove, but damn it!
Hand me that one.
God. Got it.
So that's a 10 minus 1. Wow. So that's a 9. Oh no. We've killed Talene in real life. We've really killed Talene. Head rush.
No, I needed that. Okay. It's clear in my head.
So that is a, that's a 9. So that is a hit with a race. So you are already shaken.
Ooh.
So you take 2 wounds.
Soak them.
Soak?
Wait, yeah. Is that just a hit? Doesn't he have to also roll for damage?
Oh, right. I'm sorry. That's a hit with a raise.
Yeah.
My bad.
Now, wait. I want to remind you of something because I... Okay,
no,
good.
No, I remember it.
I'm just gonna, making sure you remember okay. It's an option. Because
yeah. I
want to
see if it's something I can survive first.
Because it was a hit with a raise.
Because, as we will all remember, there are 4 more people about to shoot at me.
Well, yeah.
Well...
Because it was hit with a raise, he gets an extra d6 to his damage die.
Oof.
Oof, lost my mic. Ooh, is that an ace?
Mm-hmm.
Give me that.
I might have to use it.
It's kind of pointed inside.
Hold on. Okay, there we go.
There you go.
So that was 14, 16. All right, so what is your toughness, Tortla?
My toughness is 5.
Okay, so, ooh, that's a hit.
With 2 raises.
With...
But I can use one of these to soak.
Hit with 2 raises. Yes, so he is going to do 3 wounds to you right now.
3 wounds?
So you need to soak 3 wounds.
Yikes.
Boy.
Yeah.
I'm going to try it. Which one's a soaky one?
Any of them can be used as a soaky one. All of the white fate chip can be used to soak or reroll. The red one can be used just like a white fate chip, or you can use it to add a d6 to any roll.
You have to soak all 3, right?
Yeah, you got, well,
you can't just
I mean,
soak one?
She can soak just
okay,
one.
Okay,
she would just have 2 wounds at that point.
Okay, I understand, though.
Go for it. Soak. This is vigor. So you're gonna make a vigor roll with your wild die.
Try and
shrug off these wounds.
Come on.
Nope.
Wow. Ooh,
that's cursed
Spanish
gold. Okay. Piling up back
sixes,
here
for
Craig, though. Okay, so that is a success. You would soak 1 wound, so you would take 2 wounds at that point. But
she could roll again and still take that one.
You can.
One, right?
Yes, you can still keep the better one.
6.
There it is.
Oh, there it is.
Okay.
6 again.
The risk paid off for.
Well.
7.
Oh, not
okay,
a raise.
So that
still
is
not a raise.
You could toss a white in.
You could.
You could toss
a red in.
Although if you do that, I get that
paycheck. He gets that after.
Oh, that's true.
He gets either one.
So I either get cursed Spanish gold
or red. It'd be better
to do
the red.
I got to do this because I've got
to
like.
Or spin the white. Spin the white to just give yourself another soak.
No, you can't double soak.
Can't double soak.
Can't stack soaks.
You can use it to re-roll the vigor roll for soaking.
Right.
But you can't soak on soak.
Guys, for those of you that are new to Savage Worlds, there's a bit of a steep learning curve to the Savage Worlds combat, but once you get it, it really starts to flow. So for those of you following along in your rule book at home, make sure we're doing everything right.
Probably just Bakwad reading.
Just Bakwad.
If I re-roll, I have to hit a 6 again. That's...
Turn down the drama music because I know they're only.
You're giving him more, but you have a higher chance of raising with that, and at least soaking too.
Yeah, that's what I need is another raise.
Right.
All right. So you're adding a d6 to that roll.
Yeah.
So if you get a 5,
sure
you
can
get 2 raises. If you get anything, you get a second raise.
That's all I need. I just needed anything, but I'd really like a 6.
Wow.
Well, that's still a second 2. Raise.
Yeah. That's all I need.
That is a raise.
Take 1.
So
that's what I need.
2 wounds and you take 1. Now, guys,
I'll take that one.
I actually forgot that he was already wounded. So he should have been having a -1 penalty to all of his rolls, because each wound that you get adds a -1 to your trait rolls and your pace.
Okay.
So we will remember that from now on. You have 1 wound, he has one wound.
I need the marky thing.
I know, I don't have the marky thing, I'm sorry.
The marky mark?
The marky marks, and the funky bunch.
And the funky bunch.
All right, so that was his first attack.
Oh dear!
His second attack with his other gun. But now keep in mind, he's at a minus four for this, and a 5 for being wounded. So he's
and
at a minus 5.
And he's gonna totally mess this up.
3.
Just to keep it from slowing down. Yeah, he misses with that one.
Okay.
But I have a lot of cursed Spanish gold, so I will be using that in this fight against you guys because that's the curse. I have to do it. All right. But that is it for him.
Well.
He growls at you that his second shot missed and said, "I'm coming for you." All right. Who's up next? I think it's Gabriel Pryor.
Yeah, that's me.
Preacher Pryor.
I'm going to... So I'm hearing gunshots.
And you saw him run.
And I saw him run, so it's like, all right, this is happening.
You're clear at this point.
I'm just going to run to the top of the stairs.
You want to run right outside the door with Bogue there?
Yes.
Okay, so you make it up the stairs?
Right next to Bogue. I'll just say, evening, boys, and shoot at one of them.
Okay, do you want to shout anything out to the people downstairs in the hotel as you run through with your gun drawn? Mindful as you are of public image.
I know. Lord walks mysterious ways.
That's good, I'll take it.
That's all I got.
And you run up the stairs and you're shooting one of them. Which one?
Action
Jackson?
I'm going to shoot the guy who's furthest on the right. Actually, would it be easier to shoot? I'm going to shoot whoever's...
It's going to be easiest to shoot one of these two. You won't be at a penalty. Either one of these is going to give you a little bit of cover.
Okay, I'll shoot whoever's easiest to shoot.
Action Jackson it is.
Action Jackson.
All right, take a shot at Action Jackson.
All right, and I forget. When I shoot this, it's my...
Now, you're technically in melee range at that point, so you guys actually, since you both had your guns drawn with intent to shoot, you'd probably be back
but
a step.
I'm shooting my shooting.
Yes, this is your shooting roll. Make a
shooting
roll.
Sorry, I forgot. It's
I do want to point out...
Mm-hmm.
He's going to walk up to some guys and then just shoot them.
Yes.
Okay.
Because there's clearly gunfight
gunfire is already happening.
Gunfire has happened, but with you don't know who the good guys and bad guys are.
Yeah,
heat of battle, Tort Law.
Okay. I think I
No.
I personally
am in favor of it. Please, shoot them all before they shoot me.
That is a miss.
Mm. Or is it, though?
Cursed Spanish gold.
Oh,
no, it's not. That's a double ace.
Let me just roll both of these and see if he...
Oh, and a double one.
Okay, that's not really a snake eyes. That is...
It's not. It's just it's a seven on both. So that is a hit, but not with a raise.
Right.
So you hit Action Jackson. That's not his real name. That's the name of that miniature, though.
Okay, and
now
I...
Now you roll your damage.
That's 2d6
plus one.
Can I get a die that... Can I borrow one of these?
Yeah, of course.
These?
Go for it.
You're not going to roll the stone die?
You know, I don't know if I trust it.
Backing off on it.
It is a
smart move.
It did just roll a six for me, but, you know...
Don't push it.
It's there for wild dying.
Ooh, that's a six.
That's
all right.
That's a six. The tree is a six. 10,
go.
11.
That's an 11.
Okay, so that is a hit with a raise.
11 plus 1.
Ooh, a 12.
Yes.
Still a hit with a raise.
Well,
almost,
great.
Almost two raises, but it doesn't matter, because Action Jackson had barely begun to look over his shoulder when James Bond said, hey,
howdy boys.
And then you ran up the stairs and said, hey, boys, and shot him in the back. And he was like, wait, what? And then you drop him.
Classic preacher. Nice work.
I don't know what's going on here.
Action Jackson is dead. Give me your queen.
All right.
But
you
now
just killed a man. It's okay.
Now it's Action Jackson's turn. Or it would be if he was still alive. The rest of these guys, though.
Boke, when the people ask you did that.
So these guys are all going to turn here. You're going to run to the bathroom?
Oh, well, I might get shot at.
You might want to wait just one second. And Action Nun here is going to move into position, and they're all going to open fire on the two of you.
All of them are? None of them are shooting at me?
No, their boss seems to have you well in hand. You're cornered under a table, and he's firing off a lot of shots. Plus, this guy just dropped Action Jackson, and he was hard to the core. So they want to know what's going on with these guys that came up behind him.
All right.
So this one here is going to open up at you, Dom.
Okay.
James Bogue, that is.
Right.
Shoot and roll.
Good luck.
That's a miss.
New shooter.
But I'm going to spend this piece of cursed Spanish gold. Reroll.
He's going to miss.
Ooh.
Dang it.
That's a hit. All right. Time for damage. Only three
not
damage.
Not much damage.
Mm-hmm. You can't reroll that. You can't reroll them damages. So three damage. I assume that does not clear your toughness.
Does not.
So the bullet just grazes past your shoulder. Tis but a flesh wound. This one here is going to take a shot at you. She was sweet on Action Jackson.
And she's a nun, so she's
probably... Battle nun, gun nun. Oh, that's a miss, but I'm going to spend this piece of cursed Spanish gold.
Reroll.
Super miss. Hold on, I got one more back here.
Missing.
I got gold for days, you guys.
Oh no. Come on.
Give me that one back.
God was on my side.
That's 10.
No, he's not.
So that's a hit with a raise. So she's going to get to roll an extra d6 for her damage. So here we go. Here we go.
Give me that six. Oh no.
So that is a 10 plus 2. That's a 12. So wow. What's your toughness?
My toughness is 5.
5. So that is a hit with one raise. One raise. Right. So a hit with one raise, you are both shaken and wounded. Yep. Unless you want to soak.
I am. I can use any of these to soak, mm-hmm. right?
Any
yes.
one of them.
I'm going to use a red die to soak.
Okay, so hand me back those dice.
You know, fate chip.
Sure. Red fate chip. Make a vigor roll.
Vigor, which is a pretty good one. No, it's a pretty regular one for me.
Mm. Pretty regular stat for Gabriel Pryor.
Pretty regular
He
stat.
Is averagely vigorous.
Vigorous. Vigoroa.
Is that a 3?
It's a 3 and a 3.
Yeah. Neither one is a success.
In that case, I'm going to reroll it.
You could reroll it with Cursed Spanish Gold.
I could, but I'm going to reroll with a Fate Chip.
All right.
I really shouldn't because...
I'm just saying.
No, it's good because the Fate Chip's a race.
That's a success.
All right, so that's one. I'll keep that.
All right,
so
that'll
just shake.
It actually, it prevents the shaking as well, I believe.
Oh, it does?
Yeah.
Oh,
so nice. I think you soaked that wound, so you are not shaken. You are fine. This last cowboy right there. Evens, he goes for Bogue. Odds for Pryor. Odd, he's going for Pryor.
Let's do this.
But you got a little bit of door frame in the way, so you're going to have very light cover from him. So he's going to be at a -1 here. Ooh, which would have been a hit, but is a miss.
Light cover.
Spend one piece of Cursed Spanish Gold. Just one more.
Worth it.
Yeah. Still a miss. Truly, you are protected off by God.
Dings off of the door there.
We ain't letting you into this room. Who's up next?
It's me. All right.
Rosaline Saoirse Byrne.
I imagine she saw that.
And heard it. Yeah, she's well aware of what's happening at this point.
Yeah.
She can put two and two together.
Unhappy, and she's going to cast her...
Saw him getting shot at?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't quite see that, but you could hear it. You heard the telltale sound of Gabe being shot at.
She was.
You're like, I've heard this before.
I've heard it! Can I get all the way up here?
Uh-huh. Okay. It'll be your move.
I want to get up here and kind of get between them.
You can't move them out of the way, so you can get behind them and between them.
I don't want to get behind them.
Okay.
Can I get behind them and like put my hands in between them?
What are you trying to do?
I want to cast, I forget what it's called. What's the burst?
Oh, crap. Really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah.
I'm pissed off.
All right, we need a template for that, actually.
54 card pickup.
54 card pickup. All right. So you start running up the stairs. Did you shout out anything to the assembled crowd in the hotel?
No, I probably just. To them? No, I'm focused on
those. Forget those people.
Yeah.
All right, so you run up the stairs and you fan out from nowhere a spectral deck of cards
mm-hmm.
glowing with their obsidian light. Now, are you making a deal with the devil to cast this spell, or are you just using
your
power points?
I was going to, but it depends on if I saw him. You said I didn't see it, did I put it together?
You heard him getting shot at. I don't know what, he actually didn't get hit.
I know. Okay, then
he gritted his teeth and the bullet went straight through his shoulder.
I'll make
and
a deal.
Movie. You're going to make
okay.
a deal?
I need right. 2 power points.
She's making a deal with the devil. So you're going to draw 5 cards plus 1 card per point of grit.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6.
And now, before you turn over those cards,
mm-hmm.
how many power points do you need?
2.
You need 2 power points to cast 54 card pickup?
Yeah. I need 2.
Holy crap. All right.
Mm-hmm.
That's not very much at all.
All right.
Flip over the cards dramatically, one by one in the dice tray.
Queen
of Hearts.
Bum, bum, bum.
Queen, I already won. 9.
9.
Okay. 8.
10. And?
10.
All right.
Whoa.
So pick any 5 of those cards to make the best poker hand that you can.
Yeah, I'm going
to
go with that straight right there.
Okay. Now, what does a straight give you when you make a straight in a deal against the devil? Because I believe that ups your spell a little bit.
6 power points, excess power points, or lost.
Oh, no. It's the last thing you get before something cool.
If I had a flush, I would have gotten a raise.
Yeah, okay. So you... we'll say for the purposes of this that you can do that. Now, it's going to be a cone in front of you, right?
Yes, it's a cone in front of me.
So that'll hit all 3 of them.
Perfect.
And it won't hit Tortlock because she's under the table.
Yep.
Oh, so this is a pretty good casting of it. So you fan out those cards,
mm-hmm.
and all of this happens in the blink of the eye. But in your head, you play a game of poker against one of these guys from the hunting grounds, and you put him to shame. He retreats back into the darkness, leaving you charged with power, which you then unload
mm-hmm.
as a flurry of cards shoot out of your hands in a storm of cutting death in front of you.
Yes, so targets within the template may make agility rolls versus my arcane skill roll.
Okay, make your spellcasting roll. Because you still have to cast, you still have to actually successfully cast the spell.
Yeah.
I believe it's a D8 for you.
It is a D8. Seven,
that is a success.
Seven.
All right, so they have to make an agility roll against that.
Yes.
All right, we're making a group agility roll for these guys. Do you want me to do group or individual? It's either pass-fail on all of them, or I'll roll one for each of them.
Oh, roll one for each of them.
Okay.
Make it fancy.
Red, green, blue.
Fail all of them.
Ooh. All right, give me the blue. Okay, so blue kind of skirts to the side and steps out of the way, but these two get hit with the full force of your 54 card pickup. Roll damage.
Yes. Okay. Can I borrow a D10?
Gabriel, if anyone asked, this was you.
Let me make sure I'm right.
I'll take the bullets, you take the magic.
This counts as a heavy.
I think I can handle that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it counts as a heavy weapon, which means it can get through like tank armor.
That's 14.
Yeah. Wow. Whoa, 14?
Not magic. Miracles.
Okay.
Right.
So as you guys kind of
she's
like
a talented woman.
Nervously exchange glances, the two people in the doorway in front of you are shredded into a fine mist. There's barely any person left.
I'm all like, okay.
And you hear this guy, from over here go, what in the hell was that? And it kind of catches Craig's attention as well. I'd say that's a pretty decent turn. Rosaline, hand in your card.
Jeez.
Who's up next? Looks like it's James Bogue.
Darling, have I mentioned recently how glad I am we are working together?
No, I always love hearing it. You can say it how often you like.
Well, I'll remember to say it a little more.
What you got, Bogue?
I'm going to point my gun at this fella here, and I'm going to go, if you want more of that, drop your weapon.
That sounds like an intimidation roll to me.
Yeah, sure is.
Make an intimidation roll, and I'll give you a +2 to that, because he just saw his friends get pulverized by cards.
Six.
That aced.
Oh! Nine.
Okay, this is versus his spirit.
Bogue, at this point, we might need these guys dead.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, he's not making that. He goes, all right, and drops his weapon on the ground. So for the purposes of this, we'll just set him down like that.
Can I like, knock him out?
Yes, but that would have caused a -2 on your intimidation roll doing that.
Right.
Which would still have been a success, but if you want to do multiple actions in a round, you have to spell them out ahead of time.
Right, okay.
All right.
A little curious why they, what these guys are all up to, so that's why I didn't want to come.
Turn your card.
Yep.
Torla! Ending up the round. So you have been wounded, and you are shaken underneath this table.
Oh, so I have to shake
off
the
shaking?
So first
things first, you got to unshake. So this is a spirit roll. To shake off this face full of wood splinters and also being shot.
Yeah.
You unshake? Oh, wait, no, you're wounded, which gives you a -1 penalty.
Mm. Dang.
Cursed Spanish gold it is.
Six. Five.
That's enough to unshake.
Five will do.
All right, so you stand up. Oh, also, we haven't talked about this because we've only done one fight, but you can also spend a fate chip at any point to automatically unshake. So that is an option you have on the table as well.
Not
Cursed Spanish Gold, an actual fate chip. You can do that to unshake automatically, but I do recommend holding at least one fate chip in reserve for that critical soak roll.
Right.
All right, so you are unshaken. You may stand up beneath the table, that is. It's theoretical.
Is he under the table with
me? He's not. He's crouching down, just looking at you
under the table. I want to stand up and push the table up so that it's blocking him from shooting me anymore.
Do you want to try and just put up a barrier in between you, or do you want to try and shove the table onto him?
Barrier?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, you can do that. I will say that won't really cost you anything except your action for the round to put that up and put a barrier in between you guys.
Yep.
And then you're going to stay behind it?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, cool. All right, so the table is pushed up.
But I'm gonna be like, don't mess with the bear! Don't mess with the bear!
And are you just crouching down behind the table?
So that he cannot see me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, cool. Turn in your card. That's the end of the second round. Top of this round, James Bogue. King of Diamonds.
Ooh.
Tortla. Two of clubs. Sorry. Yeah. Rosaline, Queen of Hearts.
Yes.
Nice.
Gabriel Pryor, King of Spades.
Boom.
Nice. We're not going to deal in Craig's boys because they have laid down their arms. The one of them that isn't a puddle. So for Craig, six of hearts. Gabriel Pryor, up first.
Oh, okay.
What you gonna do, Preacher? Preacher, what you gonna do?
No, not a particularly nice guy, but I still probably shouldn't murder this guy who gave up and is lying on the ground.
I would not stop.
Okay.
If you're worried about me like having some poor reaction.
I'm going to basically like run into the room just a little further and take a shot at Craig.
Things are not looking great for Craig, you guys. he's about to get a little bit ganged up on. Take your shot.
Gonna do a Craig shot.
Craig shot.
Does he recognize?
Ooh.
Whoa.
Uh-oh.
It's a bad Craig shot.
That's a 13. 13. All right. That is a success with two raises.
Pow.
So that will shake, wound, and wound him. And he's
already
roll
for damage.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
That's just the hit.
Damn it. I'll get there. Thanks. So it's a hit with a raise, though, so you add an extra d6 to your damage roll. All
right. Oh, so can I
go? Yeah, go for it.
Guys, I'm just so excited to get to the part where you damage them. That's why.
Mm-hmm. And that is
nine.
Mm-hmm. So that is a success with one raise. So you will shake him and wound him.
That's the second wound.
It is the second wound. I'm going to soak it. He's going to make a bigger roll, but he's at a minus one because he's already wounded.
Mm. Soaking motherfucker.
Can he only soak the one he just got?
Yeah, you can't soak old wounds.
Oh. He's so good.
Seven. So that is one success. So he soaks the wound because it was just one wound?
Yeah.
Oh, yep.
Okay, and he's not shaking.
This guy.
All right.
This
so
guy.
You shoot him, and it just goes clean through his forearm, and he just seems so like jazzed up on adrenaline. He's like, he's really freaking out. He's got both guns out. He's going down in a blaze of glory. That was a good hit.
Probably should have tried to like.
Turn your car.
Squash him with a table.
Bogue.
Kind of thinking of my own skin.
Can I aim and shoot?
Do you have that? There's an edge that allows you to aim and shoot in the same round.
I don't have that.
Then you can aim this turn.
Oh, that's right.
And it'll take your whole turn to aim.
No, I'm just going to shoot.
You're just going to shoot. Okay, I think that could be that could be good.
Okay.
Do it. Shoot him in the face. In the face, James. Curse Spanish gold. Why, thank you.
Wrong face.
There you go.
Yay.
That'll hit.
So, yeah, seven.
That's a seven. That's a hit, not a raise. So roll your damage. 2d6 plus 1, I believe.
It's an 8.
It's an 8?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
All right. So that is a hit, but not with a raise. So he is shaken. So you shoot him in the leg, and it just kind of tears through a chunk of his thigh, and he kind of moves his leg out. But he seems kind of, he's starting to kind of get a little worn down by all this damage he's suffering, and he is shaken. Well done, James. Hand in your car. Up next, Rosaline. Gonna be all scary and lacerated to death with cards.
You did just like myrtillate two people.
I really would hit the marvelous Miss Sally Trenton as well with this as well.
I want to
walk. I would never forgive you.
Towards him.
Towards him. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Basically, what I want to do is just say, Craig, this night isn't turning out well for you, is it?
Okay.
I don't want to attack him.
Okay.
I want to figure out what's going on.
Guys, we have shown some pretty fucked up powers to people that we're leaving alive.
Right, that's true. But I'm trying to figure out if I can utilize this somehow. That's not really a taunt, per se.
Are you trying to get him to stop, drop out of combat?
Yeah.
He is not in a, you can tell just from looking at him, he is
enraged.
All right,
then I'll say, you've already seen what we can do. Are you sure you want to keep fighting us?
Okay. To intimidate him?
I mean, taunting is trying to get him to attack me, essentially, right?
No, taunt is just kind of like you're playing at his. You're being smarter than him. You're rubbing his nose in it. You're having a joke at his expense. You're ridiculing him in some way.
You guys are gonna be so mad when I tell you what happened.
Can I just add to it? How can that not be a taunt? Like, can't I still be like? I mean, I essentially said you're not doing very well.
Yeah. This
Can
night
I
isn't
use
going
that
away.
As a taunt?
That's a taunt.
Okay, that's what I want to do. Then.
Okay.
So
make your taunt roll. I believe it's a D4.
Yeah, it is.
D4 in your wild die. Taunt him up. Curse Spanish gold.
It's 11 o'clock.
I'll take it.
Use the chips.
That's true.
It's 11 o'clock.
Right. Oh, that's right.
However,
Rosalie knows it's 11 o'clock.
Do you keep this?
Not if you use it as a white fate chip.
Wait, what?
If you just re-roll, I don't keep it.
But I mean to the next session.
No.
Okay.
That's they all go away.
They all go away. But I'm just using They're like Cinderella's re-roll. Coach.
That's a 5.
That's a 5. So that's a success, but this is an opposed roll against his smarts, which are not super great, and he is also wounded. Yep, he fails. All right, so your next action against him is going to be at a +2.
Okay.
Turn in your card. Hand me the dice. Who's up next? It's him.
Yeah.
He's going to roll down and shake. Ah, he freaking bones it. All right, so all he can do is move. So he just sort of like is just focused on, who the hell would he be focused on? Tortla, probably. And he's just going to, like, just kind of stumble around the table and just sort of, like, confront you, but that's all he can do because he's shaken. All right, Tortla, you're up.
I want to punch him in the face.
Do it!
Yeah.
So,
classic. The old way, though.
This is, you're unarmed, so, yeah, just go for it. Go for it. Make a fighting roll.
5. I'm wounded.
And you're wounded, so that is not going to be enough to hit him. Do it!
Wow, that was... Nope.
Curse Spanish Gold. Thank you very much.
I started this session with a lot of Curse Spanish Gold.
I did too.
I still have a lot.
Unbelievable. There's a lot of table gold.
There is, yeah.
Curse Spanish Gold. There's a lot of table gold. I look forward to getting my hands on that.
Dadgummit!
Oh no, this is not going well for Tortla. She's using all her curses!
Or any of us, really, because you're getting all of
it. Wow.
You basically have to hit six, don't you?
You could start using the table.
There we go.
Hey. Double ace. Now we're doing some fighting. Now we're fighting.
So, 10.
10. All right, that is a hit with a raise. So you get an extra d6. You're going to roll strength plus d4 for hitting him unarmed.
Okay.
And then you're going to add another d6.
All right.
This is your damage. Just gonna whack him in the face.
8.
There should be a d4 in there as well.
Yeah. Strength, plus a d4.
Strength plus your d4 plus another d6.
Okay, so it's 7.
Hey. 7. All right. That is enough to clear him, and he was already shaken. So you land a wound on him. You knock him right in the face, and you hear his jaw separate and kind of twist out to the side, and he starts bleeding profusely from the mouth. But he's coming for you, Tortla. He's coming for you.
Yeah,
turn in your card. I know it's late, guys. Hang with us. We're almost there. One more round should do it. James Bogue, 4 of hearts. Tortla, 5 of clubs. So sorry. Rosaline, 4 of spades. Oh, Gabriel Pryor has dealt a joker.
Oh, man, we get more fate chips.
At this point, everybody grabs a fate chip because jokers are wild.
Is that what jokers do?
We're using a setting rule called Joker's Wild, where you all get a fate chip anytime one of you gets a joker. Oh. What jokers do is it gives you a +2 to your attack, a +2 to your damage, and you can choose to go at any point in this round. You are on super hold, and he gets a king of clubs. So a great time to use this would be to keep him from doing his thing and go, I will go in front of him.
So yeah, what's going to happen is he'll like draw his gun to shoot at Tort, or probably, and I'm just going to step off to the side and...
And everything goes into focus for you. Like, time slows down, and you're like, I can end this guy right here.
And if I have to use all the cursed Spanish gold I have, I'm going to make it a good roll. All
right.
All right, so.
+2 to your attack, +2 to your damage.
It's a 3.
So that'll be a 5. That'll
hit
him.
You know what? I still want to try and.
Wait.
Kaiken better.
Kaiken, thanks for the follow.
Thank you.
He's trying to hit a 4 because he's doing a ranged attack.
Oh. There.
That's a 7.
Okay. I was re-rolling the initial hit. I was trying
right.
to get...
Yeah, but you get a +2.
You get a +2, so
oh,
it's a 7.
Oh, that's right. So that is a 7. Okay.
So that's a success.
Still not a raise. Fuck it, that's fine.
Okay, so you hit. Now re-roll your damage.
Yeah, okay.
2d6 plus 3.
2d6 plus 3.
Because of the Joker.
That is a 9 plus 3, that's 12.
12.
Nice.
That's a hit with a raise. Just everything slows down. You see Tort about to get myrtleized. Your blood's up, and you just step into place. Anything cool you want to say before you plant one right between his eyes?
There's no God.
Oh my God! And you blow him away.
See Fry 92. Thank you for the follow.
Thank you for the follow. Life is pain.
He's like, yep, there is no God.
Follow.
Follow. I'm reading Nietzsche right now. A silence kind of falls over the room, and you hear this guy in the corner go, Oh, holy shit. Holy shit. Now, listen, I didn't want no part of this.
I run over to the fallen and immensely talented lady in the wig.
Marvelous Sally Trenton.
Yes.
I want to deal with this guy.
Okay. Guys, I'd love to have you deal with that guy, but we're at time. So we're going to have to call it right here. But I will tell you, despite all outward appearances, despite what you may think and what Tortlaw saw, maybe you guys didn't end up on the wrong side of the situation after all. For Sally Trenton, Biosep, thank you for the follow.
Thank you,
Sally
Biosep.
Trenton was an NPC brought into this game by Miss Amy Vorpal, one of our $25 Patreon backers. The Ark, spelled with a Q, is a reference to Arky Barky.
Wow.
And all of her children have names like Saucy, Kitty, Cork, and the like.
Oh, right.
Wow.
So maybe you guys ended up on the right side of the situation after all. Mm. I don't know for sure. We have to
Amy's
find
watching
out next
right
week.
Now.
She totally is. We're getting confirmation that she's definitely in chat. She's just being silent.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So, guys, that was a really good session. And I want to say, at the beginning of the session, I was going to award you guys 2 experience points for last session, which would bring your total up to 4. And at this point, I want to award you guys 2 experience points for this session, which brings your total up to 6, which means all of you have an advance, which is essentially Savage World's way of leveling up. So we will manage all of that off stream, and we'll come to the table next time and let you know how all of these guys got better in what fabulous ways. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Thank you for all of your donations. You guys unlocked 3 tier rewards.
Yes.
And I want you guys to know that reputation boost that you unlocked is going to stick around for a little while until maybe word gets out of all of the bloodthirsty murdering that these guys are doing here.
Come
in
on.
Town.
We're not doing the best job but not murdering people.
But until that point, the townsfolk are more than willing to look the other way. Yeah. So way to go, guys. Well, way to go, you guys in chat.
I'll just state my plan now in case I forget it tomorrow. I'm going to get this guy to agree that Craig did everything.
All right. Makes sense to me.
See, sometimes it's nice to keep people alive.
Right?
It'd be easier if he was dead.
And also, guys, does anyone have anything that they want to announce before we do our final goodbyes?
Next week is the season finale of Misadventures, so you should definitely check in because I'm gonna kill a character.
Oh my god!
Somebody
not joking
will
about
die.
It anymore.
Boy Chummer also.
Yeah.
So Boy Chummer is also having.
Well, don't worry, we've got a couple things in between. Mm-hmm. That, what? Yep. Dom, you said a thing. Don't bite my finger. What are you? No.
Oh god. Just do we need weapons?
Nice what? Everybody, put your guns down.
I don't have a gun, so.
Hello, chat. My name is Dom Zook, and I'm here to tell you to watch Phoenix Dawn Command tomorrow. There are some special guests, and it's going to be real fun.
And there's a marshal for that game as well.
There is a marshal.
Marshal Mack is the marshal of Phoenix Dawn.
Marshal Varia.
It's going to be an entirely marshal-based channel.
Everything marshals left and right, far as the eye can see.
Marshal. So tune in for Phoenix Dawn Command tomorrow. That's at 12:30 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, we're daylight time now, right?
Sure, whatever.
Pacific time. Tune in for that.
All right.
As far as I go, you can check me out on Twitter at Jordan Pigeon and keep an eye out for my podcast that I'm part of called This American Lie. I think we just put up a new one this week, so there's something on there. You can also check out the podcast, Guilty Pleasures Podcast, part of the Nerdist School Network, where the one that just came out last week was me talking about Dungeons & Dragons.
We know that game.
It was really fun. Yeah. It was great.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. Check those out, guys. Anything for you? No?
Nope.
Nope. Nothing. Guys, I want to remind you that apart from this weekend, next week, we've got another great lineup for you. We've got, on Monday, we'll have Couples Therapy. We'll have Dinners & Dragons on Monday night. On Tuesday, we have the season finale of Hoy Chummer, which should be
Quite, which is Shadowrun.
Quite a show. That's our Shadowrun show. On Wednesday, like Talene said, we have the season finale of Misadventures, our homebrew Harry Potter all-female cast show. On Thursday, we have... Is it Never Tell Me the Odds this week?
It's not.
Okay.
No, Never Tell Me the Odds had its season finale yesterday. So it will maybe something a little different, or it may just be a break.
We don't know.
Mm. Yeah.
But next Friday...
Surprises.
We'll be back right here for another round of Wild Cards. And I'll say, spoiler alert, we might have a... little time pass between this session and the next one, so there's a chance you might even hear a sermon from our good preacher Prior. I don't know. He doesn't
Are
know
wedding
about that.
Bells in someone's future?
I don't know. But you know what is in someone's future? The approaching storm clouds of Holbrook and his gang, who are coming to Coldwater Creek. And Holbrook, as we know, has done a little shopping. So we might have some unpleasant surprises for the Wild Cards posse. So guys, thank you so much for tuning in. We'll see you next week, I hope. Thank you so much for all your donations, for your follows. Keep spreading the word. We love having you guys. The more the merrier in chat. And we will leave you guys with some finger guns. No, he's been shot. Don't shoot him.
Oh my God,
stop me.
Don't shoot him.